Good morning and welcome to the 14th Committee in 2021 of the Finance and Public Administration Committee. Today we meet in hybrid format with the Scottish Parliamentary Corporate Bodies Agreement due to the timing and nature of our budget scrutiny. Additional mitigations are in place with fewer people attending this meeting. There is one item on the agenda today, and that is to take evidence from two panels of witnesses as part of our scrutiny of the Scottish Budget 2022-23. First, we'll hear from the Scottish Fiscal Commission, and then from David Iser, Fraser Valander Institute, and Professor Graham Roy, University of Glasgow. For our first panel, we are joined remotely by Dame Susan Rice, Chair, John Ireland, Chief Executive, and Commissioners Professor Alistair Smith and Professor Francis Breeden. We have up to 90 minutes for this discussion, and I remind members that our broadcasting team will operate their microphones. So I'd like to hear an opening statement now from Dame Susan Rice. Susan.
Thank you very much, Convener. Good morning to the committee. And I would add that in addition to my two fellow commissioners, we're also joined by John Ireland, our Chief Executive. Last week, the Finance Secretary presented the medium-term financial strategy for the next 5 years alongside her budget. Over the coming months, she'll be preparing Scotland's first multi-year resource spending review for a decade. As usual, our reports include forecasts for the next 5 years, so I thought I'd draw out specifically some of their implications for the longer-term public finances. I'll make a start with our economic forecasts, where we continue to expect a strong recovery, with Scottish GDP growing by 10.4% this financial year. We'll return to pre-pandemic levels of economic activity by the second quarter of 2022. Despite the pace of the recovery, however, there's some evidence that the Scottish economy lags behind the UK. Looking back longer term, since before the pandemic struck, employment and earnings have been growing more slowly here in Scotland, with important implications for income tax. As you'll know from our previous reports, the Scottish Government's income is largely driven by the spending decisions of the UK Government. Nevertheless, the Scottish Government's tax policies and social security commitments play an important role in determining the overall picture. We expect Scottish tax revenues to increase by 20% over the next 5 years, but the net effect on the budget will be negative in every year with the exception of 2024-25. This is because the positive contribution from Scottish tax revenues is outweighed by growth in the block grant adjustments. As defined by the fiscal framework, this is the amount removed from the Scottish budget for each tax. The slower employment and earnings growth I just mentioned results in a shortfall of £190 million in 2022-23 and £417 million in 2026-27. Last January, we highlighted a reconciliation risk arising from income tax funding in 2021-22 due to timing differences in our and the OBR's forecasts and the considerable uncertainty then around COVID-19. We now anticipate that there will be a negative reconciliation of £469 million due in 24-25. The fiscal framework requires that this reconciliation be managed within the Scottish budget. Finally, we're all aware of the significant reforms that the Scottish Government is making to social security payments. Existing payments administered by DWP on behalf of the Scottish Government are gradually being replaced by new payments, and the Scottish Government is also introducing brand new, uniquely Scottish payments. Next year, we'll also see the biggest payment, adult disability payment, launch, as well as an expansion to the Scottish child payment. So by 24-25, we expect spending on the Scottish Government's largest social security payments, along with completely new payments, to be around £750 million more than the corresponding funding received as part of the block grant, reducing the funding available for other priorities. To close, I'll mention just one component of the 2022-23 budget for the coming year. The government has assumed it'll receive an additional £620 million of resource income from a number of sources. We have reservations about the likelihood and amount of income available from some of these sources materializing during the financial year, but on balance, we consider the government's assumptions reasonable. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dame Susan. And I'll start off with the last point, simply because that's what you ended on, which was the £620 million. I mean, as you said, you have some doubts about this £620 million, whether it will actually arrive in the Scottish Government's coffers. And I'm just wondering, although you refer to Annex A of the budget document as detailing that, I wonder if you can go through what the likely what the sources are and what the likelihood is of this £620 million coming to the Scottish Government.
Yeah, so I'm sitting here with lots on my screen, but not that table. Could I turn to one of my colleagues who has their hands on it? There are five different sources for different reasons that go into the £620 million. One, a discussion about settling a number that's been going on for some years, and there are different reasons why each source is possibly uncertain in terms of when it may materialize. But Francis, are you able to speak to that?
Okay, I have. I don't have the Annex A, but I can talk a bit more about the elements. So there was some full potential, which is extra funding from supplementary estimates for the UK. So that would be a quite common factor. And indeed, it's additional funding from the spring UK fiscal events. Then there is a fourth one, which I think Susan mentioned, which is the recent agreement over the funding transfers for spillovers. And obviously, that's been an issue that's been outstanding for some time. So that's a concern whether this is the particular year it'll be resolved. And finally, there's income from the offshore wind leasing, which I guess is a more certain one. So I think. Overall, I think what we felt was, even though any one of those four may not deliver the amount of money that is expected of them, we think it's reasonable because there could be more from one than is expected. And similarly, there could be some funding from other sources, particularly underspends within the Scottish budget, which may have historically occurred and have not been factored into this one. So in a sense, whilst we have some concerns about the individual elements, why we came to the judgment the overall number was reasonable was because we felt there was a possibility that actually other sources could fill in for gaps in these sources, or indeed these sources could deliver more than is currently planned. So it's a sort of, I can see why it's a slightly odd way of putting it, but you can see our argument. We think the overall number is reasonable, even if we have concerns about the individual element.
I mean, I have to say, I think it's all a bit vague, and I think colleagues will want to explore that in some depth, because we don't see really any numbers against that £620 million and how it comes together. But just moving on to another point, in terms of your forecasting, I'm just wondering how your thinking has actually evolved since August, and why there's some changes in your judgments since that period. So, for example, one of the main surprises that came out of the budget was the £190 million reduction in the net tax position from your previous forecast. I'm just wondering if you can maybe talk us through how you come to that.
Marcus, what we have typically done and have been asked to do by the committee in the past is compare budget to previous budgets. So we make a lot of comparisons to the January budget, the last time there was a Scottish budget. But obviously, we also can comment on what has changed or moved since January. One of the things that is a little bit more normal, perhaps, now is that our budget and our work is much closer to that of the OBR, which is typical in the past. We've looked at a variety of factors, and a number of them have not changed significantly from August. And I'm just wondering if John Ireland has some detail in front of him and would like to just pull that through.
Thank you, Susan. Yes. I think just looking at the various bits which fall into the income tax forecast, since August, our GDP forecast is pretty similar. It does tailor down a little bit more at the end because we're taking a sort of, we have a little bit more information on population growth or exactly population fall. But the GDP forecast is pretty similar to August. On inflation, which obviously is important here, our December forecast has a little bit more inflation than the August forecast. So inflation has gone up in the December forecast from August. And we're still sort of forecasting in line with the OBR and inflation. But I think the interesting thing on inflation is the cause of inflation. And back in August, we were thinking there was a combination of sort of supply chain issues pushing prices up and also labor shortages. But now I think our thinking is much more that this comes from sort of the international supply chain issues and also from energy prices and much less so from labor shortages. So the story behind inflation has changed a bit. And that's important because of average nominal earnings. Back in August, we'd obviously thought that sort of the labor shortages were pushing up earnings, and now we're sort of in a position of sort of taking a little bit of back step on that, and we've reduced the pass through of domestic inflation into nominal wage growth because of our view on the source of the inflation, not so much labor shortages, but energy prices and international prices going up. And that in turn means that we've got downward revisions to our average nominal earnings growth between August and December. So earnings are growing less than we thought in August. And finally, turning to the other part of the picture, employment. Employment growth is now, a little bit lower towards the end of the forecast than it was in August. And that again comes from demographic factors. So if you take all those things together, although our December forecast for income tax is much higher than January, so the previous budget, it is actually lower than our August forecast. And that in help that starts to explain the nature of the income tax gap.
Yeah, because it's quite significantly lower than, for example, the OBR and the Bank of England, what they anticipate. So I'd be quite interested to see how that follows through. Now, one of the issues which MSPs will no doubt battle over in the Chamber in the weeks ahead will be the numbers here. So, for example, you have said in your report that the overall Scottish budget will be 2.6% lower in 22-23 than in the current year, or 5.2% allowing inflation, assuming a kind of deflator of 2.6% there. Now, obviously, we've been bombarded with a plethora of figures. So, for example, in the budget, the Scottish Government have said, and I quote, in practical terms, between 2021 and 2022-23, resource funding is 7.1% less in real terms, and the equivalent reduction for Scotland's capital grant funding, which seems to be less controversial with these figures, is a 9.7% real terms cut between 2021 and 2022-23. So I'm just wondering why you have come to the conclusion with regard to the figures you have, as distinct, for example, from some of the other figures. For example, some figures which include COVID spend have actually predicted an increase in real terms in the budget. So I just wonder if you can talk us through these figures, please.
Shall I? One of my colleagues want to pop in here.
Don't all rush. I've eeny, meeny, miny, moe. Yes, Mr. Ireland.
Yes, I think the thing to sort of focus on here is the figures that you quoted for growth in the budget. So we're saying that the budget is falling by 5.4% in real terms, and the Scottish Government is saying it's falling by 7.1% between 21-22 and 22-23. And that difference is because we focus on the size of the whole budget, whereas the government are focusing on something slightly different, which is UK funding. So I think we're taking a more holistic approach than the government in those headline figures. So that explains the difference between that headline figure. And obviously, we can get more into detail if you wish about the various components.
Again, I think I'm sure colleagues will want to push that particular issue. as I fire out all these different kind of areas, actually, which we want to cover. There's so much to cover, and I think so many issues to raise. So I'm going to mention another one, which again I think is very important. You predict a £417 million shortfall in income tax by 2026-27. So I'm just wondering how much over and above UK productivity must the Scottish economy grow to negate this figure so we don't actually end up reaching it?
A really important area to focus on, and difficult to answer specifically, but what we would point to is that we have focused, and in fact since August actually, increased our view of a declining labour market participation. That obviously has a very direct impact on income tax, and that goes through the future of our of this particular forecast. But I think Alistair would like to come in here if we can get him off mute.
Thank you, Susan. Convener, I can't answer your question absolutely directly and say how much productivity growth would be needed to reverse the income tax shortfall. But the income tax shortfall is explained by relatively low growth in Scottish earnings, which derives from productivity, and lower labour force participation than in the UK, partly because of the proportion of older people in the population, partly because young people in participation in the labour force of young people in Scotland has declined. So I apologise for not giving you a direct answer to the question, but I think the thing to emphasise about all of those factors is the relatively long-run effects. And we've seen them developing over the last few years, and they're not going to be reversed quickly. They might be reversed in due course, but it would not be sensible to think that there's going to be some quick miracle next year that will completely reverse the income tax position. It's going to, if it happens, it's going to be a slow process.
Okay, thank you for that. Now, the amount of younger people in the labour force has come up quite a lot, certainly in our private session beforehand. We also discussed that to some extent. What is the reason for that? Is it because more people are in higher education, lower birth rate? The fact that there are fewer young migrants in the population? What is the situation? Why do we have that? And why is it so different relative to the rest of the UK?
As in most questions, there are multiple reasons. If we look ahead over the 5 years of our forecast, we're expecting the number of children under the age of 16 to fall by about 60,000. So that's a number that we have pinned to that particular cohort. But if you look at the younger population overall, it is not growing, therefore fewer people going into jobs, but also a lot of younger people in work typically have been in the sort of retail, hospitality, leisure sectors, which are, you know, fairly big here in Scotland. And of course, those have been quite slow or dormant during a good bit of the last 2 years because of the pandemic. So fewer opportunities for some of them as well. So that is, you know, really two reasons why we see it's sort of less opportunity and slowly, but inexorably, a lower population as well going, you know, ready for work and looking for work.
Okay. Paragraph 22, of the budget, it talks about how poundage is below, page 22, it looks as if the poundage is below the rate of inflation for the next year. However, in terms of your own assessment, you've suggested that the non-domestic rates income will increase by 25% from 2023 to 2026-27 to more than £3.5 billion when the economy is expected to grow by about half that. What's the reason for that? Is that just inflation, or are there other reasons why you expect that income to grow?
Let me just ask, Francis, were you wanting to come in on this question or the previous one? I'm sorry.
No, it was on the previous one, so I'm not a... Yeah, I mean, I think, although it is true that generally property has done relatively well, and that's a factor here, but to give a nice answer to that question, Andrea.
Hospitality leisure reliefs between England and Scotland, for instance, for the relief that's offered in England, at least at this point in time, shows for the fiscal year of 2022-23. The Scottish version lasts for the first 3 months of 2022-23. So there is a difference there. Both reliefs are set at the same level, which is at 50%. Otherwise, the reliefs are fairly much in parallel, but you know that's one element here. So neither applies to aviation, which they did previously, but only to the retail, hospitality, and leisure sectors. Alistair, do you want to put some flesh on this?
Well, just to add one point, which is that like many other aspects of the economy, the non-domestic rates revenue fell in the COVID-driven recession and has bounced back. So part of the growth that we're forecasting for the next year, part of that is explained by bounce back towards, a bounce back from previous levels has taken place and that's continued. So it's just part of the general bounce back of the economy from COVID.
Well, I mean, if you take the nadir of business rates to 2027, the growth will be 69%. That's why I didn't actually take the nadir. It was from 22-23 to 26-27. You know, obviously I discounted that because that was an unusual year. There's still a 25% growth in rates, and that's obviously quite a lot for the business community to actually cough up. So that's why I was wondering if that's your view of where that money is going to come from. Is it being driven by, as I said, inflation, or is it because it's twice the level of growth? So I'm just wondering why you're predicting it to increase from 2.8 to £3.5 billion over that that four-year period. It seems quite a big increase in a relatively short period of time.
John, did you want to come in on this?
I think one way of thinking this through is to look at our budget forecast last year and compare it with our budget forecast this year. And if you do that, then the thing which is sort of driving the biggest increases in revenue here is basically inflation. So if you sort of just let the forecast increase by inflation, by the end of the forecast, that adds about 137 million to the forecast, and that's the biggest driver if you sort of separate it into its various components. Remember here the sort of the tax base is fixed because it has quite little to do with economic activity because of the nature of the tax. So inflation is a really big driver, and then the Scottish Government have increased poundage not by the amount of inflation but just under the amount of inflation, and obviously that takes a little bit off of that increased revenue. But I think the biggest driver here is probably inflation.
Okay, thanks. I was just wanting clarification, so thanks on that. Now, in Social Security, you're predicting that well, by 24-25, there'll be a £764 million shortfall in terms of Social Security spending. When you look at that figure, I mean, obviously some of these measures are fixed and will remain within the budget, but surely some of the measures that are being introduced in terms of trying to drive down levels of poverty, the idea is to actually reduce the number of people who actually are eligible and claiming those benefits. Has any of that been taken into account in assessing these figures?
A couple of comments to start, and then again I'll turn to colleagues. One of them is that figure that you read out is the figure we've reported on, it is probably somewhat conservative in the sense that we've taken the biggest Social Security payments, which have or will have by next year transferred to Scotland, and we've taken the brand new payments such as Scottish Child Payment and added up those forecasts over the next 5 years. But other payments, some of them already devolved to Scotland and have been for a couple of years, based on the formal undertaking by Social Security Scotland to try to increase uptake of benefit payments, they have been tweaked or changed or recast in Scotland so that it may be, in some cases, easier for people to apply the renewal or restatement of eligibility may be easier. There are various ways the advertising attracting people in may be different, so may be more expansive than would have been under the DWP. And all of that means that some of the other benefits also will be increasing in number. So I just want to clarify that that number is a somewhat conservative one, just by way of starters and background. Alistair, you're wanting to come in on this.
Thank you. Yes, well, I'd pick up two examples to try and answer your question, Convener. One of them is Scottish Child Payment. We do, in our projections for the cost of Scottish Child Payment, allow for the fact that the number of families eligible for Scottish Child Payment is likely to fall a little bit in the near future. But effects like that are frankly dwarfed by the costs of the doubling of Scottish Child Payment, which the government has now announced. So we're looking at any effects from a welcome reduction in family poverty are relatively small compared with the costs of doubling. And then the other big element in our budget projections for Social Security is the cost of adult disability payment. And adult disability payment is simply not doesn't change very much with what's going on in the economy, and in particular with family poverty, because it's driven by disabilities which are typically long-standing, and where individuals' eligibility for adult disability payment is not driven by their economic circumstances, driven by their disabilities, whatever they are. So for different reasons, neither of those items, and those are the really two biggest things in our budget projections for Social Security, none of them are going to shift very much in response to any welcome changes in family poverty that take place in the next few years.
Okay, thank you. And a final question from myself before opening out to colleagues around the table. You said that over the next 5 years, you expect capital funding to fall in cash and inflation-adjusted terms. And in paragraph 42, you say that's primarily because of the reduction in UK government funding. So what is the implications of this for Scotland's borrowing limit and its ability to take forward capital projects?
Don, do you want to come in?
Yes, so there's basically, between the first year of the budget and the final year of our forecast, a 15% fall in the capital budget available to the Scottish Government. A lot of this is driven by falls in basically UK capital spending, which are then passed on to the Scottish Government. It is true, however, and you're perfectly right to call attention to it, that because the government has been trying to always plans to borrow the maximum amount that it can on the capital side, £450 million a year, it's sort of heading up towards its limit on borrowing. And towards the end of the forecast period, we're thinking that they're probably, because they're going to be approaching the limit, they'll be able to borrow less. So there's certainly a factor there that the limit is the upper limit on capital borrowing is starting to bite, we think, before the end of the forecast. One sort of caveat to that is, though, although each year the government does say that they'll borrow £450 million, quite often they borrow slightly less. So perhaps we're going to hit the capital limit slightly later than the government plans indicate.
Okay, thank you very much for that. So the first colleague to ask a question will be Liz, to be followed by John.
Thank you very much, and thank you for informing us a bit more on some of these trends. Can I concentrate on the income tax receipts issue, particularly the fall that you have been predicting? And could I ask, first of all, about some data? May economists obviously talk about the Laffer curve, and I know that that's been a bone of contention when it comes to some political issues, but nonetheless, that curve is important because it's the relationship between the tax rate and what is actually collected in revenues. And so I wondered, in terms of your updated data, do you have information about the taxable income elasticity, in other words, the taxable income change in response to the changes in the rate of taxation, because that's obviously important for policy. Do we have good data on that?
Alistair, over to you.
It's an issue that is very hard to get good data on, but it's an issue that has been extensively studied in a variety of countries with a variety of fiscal arrangements, and we are in our projections assuming taxable income elasticities of which have an impact on Scottish income tax revenue as Scottish rates rise or Scottish rates diverge from the UK rates. So we have taken into account these taxable income elasticities at a level that's in line with other studies, but frankly, those kinds of effects are not the big factors in driving our projections of Scottish income tax revenue. So it's very interesting to talk about Laffer effects and all of that, but that's not at the heart of what's going on here. What's really going on here, as I said in answer to the convener's previous question, is that these income tax projections are driven by Scottish earnings growing a little bit less fast than earnings in the rest of the UK, partly the decline of the Scottish oil and gas sector, partly the buoyancy of the UK financial sector in London and the South East, and also driven, as I said earlier, by declines in labour force participation relative to the rest of the UK. Those are the big impacts on our tax projections, not the behavioural tax elasticity effect.
Is it not the case, however, that notwithstanding what you've just said about these big factors, that these factors do actually have very considerable implications for the amount of the tax take that comes to Scotland? And therefore, when a government comes to decide on its tax policy, the projections that you're giving about revenues in relation to the factors you've just mentioned are actually extremely important.
Oh, yes, they're certainly important. And they might be particularly important in the Scottish environment, where it's relatively easy for individual taxpayers to choose. Or it might be relatively easy for some higher rate taxpayers to choose residence in the rest of the UK rather than in Scotland. That might be particularly easy when someone switches jobs. Do they move the primary residence in or out of Scotland? But we have taken those factors into account. They're built into our forecasts. Yes, I agree they're important. We have considered them.
Thank you for that.
Sorry if I can make one other point. And I think they have influenced Scottish Government's policy in that the divergence in tax rates between Scotland and the rest of the UK has been relatively modest, particularly the 1% divergence in the tax rate. I'm sure that's been a question for the Scottish Government, not for us, but I'm sure that's been influenced by concern that if they push the tax rates too far away from UK rates for higher rate taxpayers, that the effects that you're concerned about would get larger.
Yes, thank you. And as you say, that's maybe an issue for the Cabinet Secretary in due course. Can I just ask about what you said regarding the oil and gas situation? You said that was one of the big factors having an effect on this. To what extent do you think that the decline in the oil and gas sector is having perhaps one of the biggest effects on reducing the tax take?
I hesitate to say it to try and rank the different effects, but the decline of high incomes of the decline of the oil and gas sector means that there are fewer high income taxpayers in the Scottish economy than there were a few years ago, and that has had a significant impact on Scottish tax take. In our report in the economy section, we've looked at regional differences in Scottish incomes, and the most striking regional decline in Scotland is in the northeast, and that seems to be driven by oil and gas.
So it would be fair to say that, given obviously the transition to net zero and the predictions that the oil and gas industries will diminish further, that the predictions as a result of that will cause ongoing issues for the tax take. That's your prediction?
Yes, though one has to be really careful about thinking about timescales in this. Our tax projections are for the next 5 years. The effects on the Scottish economy of the, if it is, and we ought to expect there to be a long-term decline in the oil and gas sector because of climate change concerns, that's something that happens over a much longer period. So I'm not at all downplaying that. But that's a long-term issue for the Scottish economy, but it's not really reflected very much in our forecasts, in the sense that the current decline in the Scottish oil and gas sector is largely not driven by climate policy. It's driven by the gradual decline of resources in the North Sea.
Okay, my final point. Sorry,
forgive me for interrupting. I think Francis had a follow-on response to that question, if you don't mind.
Yeah, I just wanted to sort of maybe slightly move away from the oil and gas, in the sense that I think the other thing you see from that regional chart that we have in the document is that all regions in Scotland have underperformed relative. So I think although oil and gas is a factor, I wouldn't put it in as number one factor. I think the two participation effects are the key ones that are going on. So I just wanted to highlight that.
Thank you for that. And that leads into my final question, which is about the sort of participation rates and the sort of changing demography within the labour market, because obviously there are concerns there, particularly in relation to the number of young people who perhaps have more transferable skills for the future coming into the market. To what extent do you feel that these are significant issues in terms of projections for the future?
I'll give you a quick answer and then see if anyone wants to follow me. But I think the labour participation rate and the fact that it's declining and has been doing so over a number of years now is a significant factor. And it's because at the same time, the overall population of Scotland isn't growing and isn't projected to grow. In fact, it is coming down, or the working age population, put it that way, is coming down over the next 5 years by about 50,000. So you have more people, on that older end, if you would, and then fewer actually active. The convener asked a question earlier about differences, what would it take in Scotland in terms of difference in productivity rates? I couldn't answer that question directly, but I think it's worth considering that if we're already lagging to some extent, our productivity, even if it were on a par with England or the rest of the UK, wouldn't catch us up because we wouldn't be there yet, if you see what I mean. So our productivity would have to go up quite significantly to make that comparative difference decrease. I think Francis, Alistair, I think maybe you want to come in on this point.
Yes, thanks. Susan, you already responded to the convener's question about young people's participation. The other big factor in Scottish participation rates is the ageing of the population. And that's driven fundamentally by Scotland having had for quite a long time now relatively low birth rates, and that feeds into a demographic picture where the older part of the population constitute a larger percentage than they would in a population that had a higher birth rate, and that's a really long run effect. So I fear that whatever we might hope to see, there are reasons you might expect young people's participation to change, possibly if various things change. But the demographic effect of Scotland having a relatively high proportion of its population over the age of 65 is something that's going to be with us for a long time.
Thank you very much, Convener.
Thank you. John, to be followed by Daniel.
Thanks, Convener. I mean, maybe just to kind of follow on that point. I mean, I'm not going to ask you if we're actually sending too many young people to university, but am I right in saying that if we sent less to university and had more working and maybe doing apprenticeships in the short term, that would boost the economy, although in the long term it might have a more damaging effect?
You could argue, I mean, that point could be argued in different ways. If it led to an increase in number of people actively working and employed, it would have a short-term positive impact. Apprenticeships are not necessarily the highest paid roles, and the number of young people who might go through that kind of program, or the change in balance between those going to university and those maybe going straight to apprenticeships, would not be huge. So I'm not sure how much of an impact that would have. And this is a personal view, would have thought that more young people getting more education and, if possible, and relevant university education in the longer term is the better thing, because they may be better able to find jobs, to find a range of jobs as the emphasis on different types of jobs and different industries ebbs and flows, and they might well be higher earners in the longer term as well. So I'm not sure what you're suggesting. Rationally, yes, it does make sense, but I'm not sure that would make a lot of impact or enough to suggest that we should do that. Alistair, do you have a view as well?
Well, the first thing to say is that perhaps suggesting a panel that includes two professors that too many people go into higher education is probably not a proposition we'll readily agree with. But actually, my serious point is that we don't controlling what young people do with their education and with their lives is not something that governments directly control. Young people choose to go to university, or they choose to go into other forms of further education, or they choose to go into apprenticeships. And it's not an instrument that we have available to us. There may well be a strong case for making more vocational forms of education attractive to the young people, but we have to face that. That's what you have to do. You have to encourage them to choose that. And as Susan said, they will choose the path that seems right for them rather than the path that we, whether we professors or politicians, would like them to take.
Okay, thanks for that. I don't want to spend too much longer on that, really, because although one of my nephews, aged 22, has not gone to university and has done extremely well and has bought his own house. However, I think my main point I wanted to go on to was the GDP growth rates. And we had an interesting paper from Spice referring to some of the growth rates that are predicted. And they've been made over a relatively short time, but I think timing may be part of that. So if I just quote them, I mean, the Scottish Fiscal Commission, 3.8% for 2022, Fraser Valander, 4.8%, OBR, 6%, NIESR, 4.7%, Bank of England, 5%, and HMT, 5%. And in that sense, the OBR seems to be a bit of an outlier in being quite high. Theirs was made in October, which is only 2 months ago. Yours is more recent. So can you say a little bit more about these differences? And, I mean, should we consider... Obviously, this is having a real effect on our budget, but, you know, the OBR 6% seems very high.
So I'm looking for who would like to come in on this one. Francis, are you...
I think so. We have a table in our document, which is slightly different from yours. I think that's why we had a little bit of confusion. So we had for 2021, the OBR 6.5 and then 6, which is roughly in line with the average of forecasters, which was 7 and then 5. So that's pretty much similar. So I think, in fact, I mean, given how volatile economic circumstances have been in the last few years, there's actually a remarkable consensus among forecasters that we're roughly in the same place. And clearly, all of these forecasts were produced, including ours, before Omicron really took hold. And therefore, there may be a significant revisions around the corner for all of us if this continues to, if it gets worse than the situation already is.
I mean, I do take that point, but it seems to me that this is having a real effect on our budget in the short term, although it'll all come out in the wash, I accept, in the long term. Because, I mean, previously we had this Scottish-specific economic shock, if I've got the words right, which was really a timing thing, I think, between your forecasts and the OBR. And I just wonder if we're having this in reverse at the moment, that they made an optimistic for the UK forecast of 6% in October... You're now saying 3.8% for Scotland in December. Is this just a timing thing, or is it a mixture of timing and reality?
I think it's a mixture, yeah. So I think I would say that our forecasts are relatively close in time this time. And indeed, unlike the previous occasion when a lot happened in between our forecasts, this time not a lot happened, and indeed, as I mentioned, our forecast. So I think it's slightly different. Obviously, some of it is to do with the fact that we've been discussing. We generally think that there is slightly slower growth in Scotland than the rest of the UK, you know, as a factor. But I think it's fundamentally it's a slight difference in forecasting approaches will always cause some differences, and as you know, that comes out in the wash with reconciliations.
Okay. Okay, if I could move on to a slightly different point. You know, if we are heading, you make the point in paragraph 39, page 14 of your report about the, you know, we're heading towards this £469 million reconciliation for 24-25. And you make the point, and it would seem common sense, that, you know, if any government knew they were doing that, they would perhaps slightly underspend going forward each year. But you're highlighting that there's a problem that we can't really save up that money in preparation because of the rules around the Scotland Reserve. Could somebody maybe just kind of expand on that and explain that to me and others?
Could I turn to John first and then Francis for a follow-on to that comment? No, Francis first.
So it's the, you know, something we've tried to highlight quite a few times is that, you know, I know that there's a concern about the borrowing limits, but actually there's a, you know, the upside is also constrained in the fiscal framework, and that means that so as you've rightly pointed out, because we had the Scottish specific economic shock that continues to affect the rest of the borrowing and the reserve limits for not going to need all carry on until 23-24. That gives the Scottish government more flexibility to borrow and to put money into the reserve. You know, as unfortunately in terms of the timing, that rolls off exactly in that year 24-25, so that the borrowing limit is only 300 in 24-25 against a reconciliation that we think is only bigger than that. And indeed, the reserve, the annual drawdown of the reserve is 250, and the limit of the size of the reserve is 700. So, and what we've seen in the past with the reserve is that it's almost all used to manage underspends and, you know, just departmental spending issues. So, and since the reserve has not a lot of capacity left over to look after reconciliations as well, and therefore that big reconciliation we're looking at 24-25 is one that will result in having, you know, potentially one-off changes in spending or taxes to deal with, because the capacity of the system to absorb it is limited.
Okay, thanks for that. I think it does get quite complex, and presumably that's going to be one of the things they discuss when they get to the reviewing the fiscal framework. So, I mean, I think my last point kind of linked to that is on page 29, 2.35, talks about the Scotland Reserve and the average underspend, and the point that the utility of the reserve is actually reducing. It was 2.1%, it's now 1.5%. Could you, maybe it's yourself as well, Professor Breeden, can you explain just why that's happening?
Okay, well, I think there is a factor that basically, as the budget grows, I think this may be the point, someone might want to come in and bring another point in, but one of the key factors is that the limits in the framework are fixed, and obviously the combination of inflation and just the growth in the size of the budget in real terms as well means that, you know, trying to manage a bigger and bigger budget within what are nominally fixed limits will become an increasingly difficult thing over time. So it's not as if we can say, well, you know, these limits are fine because they were fine in the past. They'll actually become more and more constraining in the future because of the size of the budget grows. The size of the underspends, the size of reconciliations will naturally grow with them.
Thanks very much, John. And we'll now have Daniel to be followed by Ross.
Thank you, Convener. I want to move on to regional comparisons across the UK. But before I do that, I really want to sort of extrapolate the overall implications in the medium term in terms of the funding envelope. I mean, I think it's fair to say that the thing that took most people by surprise was that the net tax position essentially reducing the available funding by 190 million rather than adding to the funds available. But looking more deeply into your report, that picture is just going to, I think, increase in terms of its, you know, the issues that it causes the Scottish budget. So I just would like to just check in terms of what you're saying the implication is. If I look at chapter two, look at figures 2.1, 2.3 and 2.4, a block grant, as you are saying, is essentially going to stay flat over the next 5 years. The net tax position by 2026-27 will increase to a negative impact of 355 million. But critically, the new social security spend plus additional spend will be an additional 764 million. So is the implication of all of that is that the essentially 1.119 billion will have to be found within the Scottish budget within the next 5 years. Is that the correct analysis to draw from looking at those three trends of block grant, net tax and social security spend?
That isn't the exact lens that we have taken to it. So I'm looking for one of my colleagues to lean forward and you know, give the answer. And I think that might be Alistair. Really, what we're saying here is simply to highlight, since the Scottish budget has to be balanced every year, that as there is a commitment to spend more on through Social Security payments to enable benefits to society as a whole, that those additional outflows of money will have to be balanced against other spending priorities. So that's the kind of take we've brought to this area. But Alistair, did you want to come in with a more specific response?
Well, basically, just to agree in broad terms with the question, and I think, Susan, you've responded to it. I don't want to bandy numbers around, but broadly speaking, the picture is right. Devolved taxes we're projecting are going to contribute less to the budget than in the past. The block grant is constrained, and social security expenditure is projected to increase. And with a balanced budget, there's pressure coming on the budget from two or three sides that will put pressure on non-social security expenditure. The facts of arithmetic.
Thank you. That's very helpful, and I think it's important, because if we are looking forward to a comprehensive spending review at halfway through the next calendar year, this will give a picture of the overall envelope that will have to work within. I think that the next key question, and it obviously touches on the point around net tax, the net tax position, is why Scotland is performing less favourably compared to the rest of the UK. And I think the big change for me is that's not just compared to London and the South East, as has been alluded to certainly by the Cabinet Secretary, but that's really compared to every single other region across the UK as a whole. And I have to say, as I was saying to committee members in private session before this, my rough rule of thumb is always to assume we'll be behind London and the South East, but somewhere around the southwest, and normally a bit better than places like Wales and Northern Ireland. But that is not the case when we look at our net income tax position. And indeed, you know, every single Scottish region is lagging pretty much every single region of the UK. Why are these impacts so much more significant in Scotland than they are in places, say, such as the northeast of England or the Midlands, which might have comparable demographics, one would suppose, to Scotland?
Francis, did you want to?
I mean, one thing I'd say, I think the chart we have in the document is only 1 year, so it's September 21, so that's obviously a key year for this budget and for our analysis, but I think it may be just we've got a snapshot of a particularly unfortunate combination for Scotland. So I think the longer term trends are probably, if I recall, more of the type that you're talking about. But that doesn't take away from the point that we've raised, is that this labour market participation and also this oil effect, you know, are things that are going on in Scotland that don't seem to be going on as much in the rest of the UK. The demographic effect is UK-wide, as I say, Scotland does seem to be particularly affected.
I mean, it strikes me that this is an area that requires much more attention, both on behalf of government and indeed the Parliament. You know, both the specific point about labour market participation, but I just struggle to understand how that explains it in its entirety, given that you'd have thought those demographic challenges would appear in other regions of the UK. Scotland is not so different to places such as the north of England or indeed Wales. Where should we be looking to explain this and do further analysis so we can adopt the right policies to address it?
So I certainly agree that this is an issue that is worth a lot more thought. And again, I would re-emphasise my point of saying that I think how Scottish versus the rest of the UK position will look very different depending on what window of comparison you use. So I wouldn't necessarily say suddenly Scotland has got a lot worse and will remain a lot worse. I think different windows will give a slightly more balanced picture. But I do agree with you that these participation effects are important because obviously a key question is, are they cyclical? Will they, particularly the youth participation one, is that something that will just resolve itself over time? Or are they something that is structural and will continue? And obviously that has huge implications for future budgets.
I'm going to ask just one final question. I mean, one of the explanations also is sort of the relative performance of the financial services sector, in the rest of the UK as compared to Scotland. Now, my understanding has always been that we have a strong financial services sector in Scotland. So why would the financial services sector in Scotland be underperforming the rest of the UK?
So I was going to come in and say something about that, not to give you detail about the financial services sector, but it really is booming. That's mainly sort of in and around London for various reasons. It's the continued interest from a number of financial institutions that are more international, more global, of being in the UK, continuing to want that, and London is a real financial centre for them. It's that some of the reflects perhaps some of the shift of what we used to think about as Scottish financial services to being sort of managed and operated outside of Scotland. And the question is a little bit broader than just the one sector. So we've said in the report, part of this difference is because financial services really is booming there. It's fine in Scotland, but it's not booming. It's not growing to the same extent. And that's a difference in expansion of that sector, if you will. And then the other side is, which we already mentioned, which is the oil and gas sector, which is, right now in the doldrums, which is not a technical economic term, but it has slowed down. So one of the things I might suggest is that in trying to find answers to your question, one looks at the major sectors and what's happening in them. So those are two that we pulled out. There may be other kinds of activity that affect other areas, and also relating to your regional lens in your question, a lot of the financial services firms that are booming, if you will, in the London and Greater London area have also established quite significant presence in other parts of England quite intentionally. So the biggest bank, for instance, or one of the biggest banks, has a huge centre in Birmingham, just as an example. So it isn't just London, but as they grow, they also expand employment elsewhere.
Thank you. Doldrums might not be a technical economic term, but it's a very good descriptive one. Anyway, I'll hand over at that point.
Indeed. Ross, to be followed by Douglas.
Thanks, Convener. I'd like to return to the point that Daniel's exploring there around the income tax deficit. And looking at figure 4 in your report, the broad trend from 21-22 to 26-27 is pretty clear. But I'm interested in what you're projecting for the year 24-25, where that gap closes considerably and then begins to widen again for the rest of that period. What caused that change in direction in your projections?
Again, I've got other documents in front of me, so one of my colleagues who has that table could perhaps come in. Right, Alistair, you seem to be ready.
Yeah, what we're projecting for next year, for 22-23, is a very natural follow-on from the position in the current year, and we're expecting the net position to deteriorate by almost 200 million over that two-year period. Your question about the next year gets us into complications, because the complications which are, in a, you know, don't just make the explanations more complicated rather than being inherently complicated. But the UK government has announced that it's going to freeze the higher rate tax threshold for several years ahead. So that's a, and we make our forecasts on the basis of announced government policy. That's a UK announced government policy. The Scottish government has only committed to freezing its higher rate threshold for 1 year ahead. So 2 years ahead, we're assuming that the Scottish higher rate threshold is going to rise with inflation, which reduces the policy gap between Scotland and the rest of the UK. Now, are we certain that the Scottish higher rate threshold will rise? No, it's just reflecting. In fact, they have not made an announcement about that. So years beyond 22-23 start to involve assumed differences between Scottish policy and UK policy, which may just be announcement differences. Whereas for 22-23, the position is clear. The big differences between Scotland and the rest of the UK are the tax rates in Scotland, which are not going to change, and the difference in the higher rate threshold, and that difference is not going to change next year. Going further ahead, there are more moving parts, so we can be a little bit less certain about exactly how the numbers are going to turn out. So I would rather say that when we're looking at the years beyond 22-23, the actual divergences that we're projecting have a bit less certainty about them because they're policy independent, but the persistence of the general pattern is testament to the fact that the forces underlying this negative and declining net income tax take for Scotland, those are long-run forces. The arithmetic may vary a bit, but the issue is going to be a pretty persistent one.
That's a useful clarification. Thanks for that. If I could stick with you for a moment, Alistair, just a small point of clarification to one of the answers that you gave to the convener around your projections for the cost of the Scottish child payments. You said that the numbers there take into account a slight fall in the number of eligible children. Can I just check, is that due to the fact that the population of children is going to shrink, or is it due to an assumption about reductions in child poverty levels, or both?
No, it's largely driven by the demographics, that the population of young people is going to decline, and therefore the population of young people in families eligible for the Scottish Child Payment will decline for the demographic reason. And actually, perhaps it's worth saying that there are some forces that push us slightly in the opposite direction, because there's an interaction between eligibility for Scottish Child Payment and Universal Credit. And the change in the taper rules for Universal Credit mean that families who previously, a number of families who previously were not eligible for Scottish Child Payment are now brought into eligibility, not because they become poorer, but because of the UC taper. And also, the existence of a doubled Scottish Child Payment gives a bit of an incentive for people who might not have claimed Universal Credit before to make sure they claim, because the benefits of claiming are greater. So the straight answer to your question is the declining numbers is largely driven by demographics, and the other effects affecting Scottish Child Payment, some of them go in one direction, some of them go in another, and we're not assuming that in the short run there's going to be a big reduction in family poverty that would affect eligibility for Scottish Child Payment.
Thanks. And sticking with the issue of demographic change, but in a different area, and following on from John's line of question around falling labour market participation by young people, obviously that is in part due to falling birth rate, which is a long-term problem that we're familiar with in Scotland. But the one significant difference that we're going to have over the next 5 years compared to the last 15 is a change in immigration policy post-Brexit. How much are you building in an assumption of a change in the number of young people in the workforce based on immigration changes compared to that long-term issue of birth rate that we're familiar with?
Who's on? But I was going to say... what I was going to say is that our Brexit assumptions, which we have shared for a number of years now, are built into our work here and are implicit in it. So we've been thinking about that particular factor for a while. It's not a new factor that we've suddenly considered, but it's there as part of our underlying considerations. Alistair, were you wanting to say something on this?
Well, just to add that yes, we do assume in our population projections that Brexit and other factors will have an effect on international migration into Scotland, and it will decline. The effects of that are smaller than the effects of demographic change. So yes, it is a factor, but it's not as it's just in demographic arithmetic is not as big a factor as the declining birth rate.
Great, thanks very much. And another point, again, I recognise, Susan, what you said, you're dealing with different papers, but figure 316 in the papers that we've got is looking at the changes in PAYE employment from start of last year compared to October this year. And already discussed the significant regional effect in the northeast due to oil and gas, where they've got significant decline in employees there. But the other area in Scotland that is in decline is Eastern Scotland. I wonder if you could talk a little bit about the particular regional forces that are driving that. We're all very familiar with what's going on in the northeast, but I'd be interested in hearing a bit of explanation about why Eastern Scotland is also in quite a different position to the rest of the country.
Francis, I think you want to come in.
I was actually going to ask something for the previous question, but it was. It gets much harder when you get down to, and we don't. When we do our forecast, we're not sort of building up from regional forecasts up to the. We do so. I think when we talk about individual regions, it gets increasingly difficult to tell. We can try and tell stories about why they're different, but I think it actually is. It gets increasingly difficult to pinpoint key factors because clearly different parts of the economy just perform differently.
So I think you said you were looking to come in on the previous question as well. If you've got something to add on that, feel free. Don't feel
that
we've cut you off.
If you were really interested, I was going to give you the numbers about migration, which was we have our own population assumptions, including migration. We have. Zero, I think, for net migration in the coming year, and then we have a net of 4,000, I think, in the future. So I think it just reinforces Alistair's point that these are pretty small numbers compared to the overall demographic effects.
Thanks very much. I'll leave it there for now, Convener.
Thank you very much. Douglas, and followed by Michelle. Yeah,
thank you, Convener. As a new member, I just wanted to check something on the income tax table on figure four. So am I right in thinking that if we hadn't devolved income tax, the Scottish taxpayer would be £742 million better off, and also the Scottish Government would be £190 million better off? Is that right, or am I missing something?
Alistair?
It's not quite right. Because that £740 million figure is a figure that's calculated on the assumption that there had been no Scottish policy changes. But the effect of devolution is that not only can Scotland introduce its own active income tax policies, but it's no longer following the UK policy. So, when we're doing our arithmetic and we're looking, for example, at the effect of Scotland setting a higher rate threshold, we're defining Scottish policy as being a Scottish higher rate threshold that doesn't go up with inflation. Whereas the rest of the UK has had a policy towards the higher rate threshold, which is to push the higher rate threshold up to a level way above an inflation adjustment. So the better figure to look at in thinking about what would happen if income tax were not devolved would be what would be the effect if Scottish income tax policy were the same as UK tax policy. And for 22-23, that number is not 742. And we don't have a projection for that for 22-23, because that's not what we've looked at. But Spice projected a number for 21-22 for the divergence, which is minus 530 million. And projecting forward, the arithmetic that produces that number of 530, the number for 22-23 would not be 750, but more like 800. So, sorry, that's a very long answer to make a small adjustment to your figure. And the important part of the answer to your question is yes. These numbers do mean that if Scottish income tax had not been devolved and had stayed with UK income tax policy, it would have made a difference of the order of 750 to 800 million pounds to the Scottish budget.
Is that just to the Scottish taxpayer, or would the Scottish government have extra money as well because of the block grant adjustments? Or I guess there wouldn't be adjustment.
That's after the block grant adjustment for income tax. So the Scottish government's position is not as negative as 750 or 800 number would imply, but it's because Scotland has raised its tax, some of its higher tax rates, and frozen the higher rate tax threshold, and that has generated income from Scotland. But in future years, we're projecting that extra income from increased taxes in Scotland will not be sufficient to make up for the loss of income through the block grant adjustment.
Thank you. Other question I had was around, there's no mention in your report about council tax. Is there a concern that, with the council tax cap being removed, that would bring an overall burden to the taxpayer, increase our overall level of tax, and that could have a damaging impact on the economy?
Could I just respond without meaning to avoid the question, but council tax is not part of our remit at all, so we haven't explored it, examined it, and that's why we don't address it in any full way in our report. So maybe you would get more depth of response in another suite of evidence sessions then from us, because we don't look at that.
Okay, I'll move on. When I was reading the report, it seems to be that, and I think Daniel mentioned this earlier, that tax earnings are falling compared to the rest of the UK. Social security charges are rising compared to the rest of the UK. Working population falling compared to the rest of the UK. Economic growth lower than the rest of the UK. And recovery slower in Scotland. I'm just, when I read all this, I'm concerned about, how sustainable is this going forward? And would there need to be action taken in the short term to try and stop some of this figures that we're seeing coming through?
So it's the correct kind of question in general to be asking. If the plan in Scotland is to spend more for social benefit, then that would be taking priority over possible other expenditures. It's a matter of balancing how to make those discrepancies, if you will, come out whole at the end of the day. So if you spend more here, you spend less there. But it's the right point to be focused on, that there's growth or decline in different directions, and Parliament quite rightly should be thinking about this.
Okay. Any other comments from anyone else? I guess a no. Okay. Thanks, Camilla.
Okay. Thank you, Michelle.
Good morning. Firstly, I want to go back to right to where we started, to yourself, Professor Breeden. I couldn't quite hear your answer to what specifically was contained within the 620 million other income. I heard spillovers and I heard underspends, but I genuinely couldn't hear what you said. So I suppose my question is, what estimates have you put in there and at what levels? Because I suspect we also will want to probe with the Scottish Government what's in there. So if you don't mind just running through. And in particular, I would say I'm also interested in how you, and if indeed you have factored in the health and social care levy in your projections, and you estimate that the Scottish Government have done the same. I understand that Treasury says they're in there, but again, I don't have a tangible sense of at what level specifically in the budget. So those two things, thanks.
Okay. I couldn't find the other page. I have to do this from memory, but it was the supplementary estimates at the time, which will come back in February. There will be the UK fiscal event, so that could generate funding. So there's supplementary estimates which will generate extra funding, and they appear. There's fiscal events in the UK that could generate extra funding, and both of those is an assumption that something will come. Then there is the resolution of the spillover question, which could generate income, and if obviously if the spillover cases resolve this year, that'll generate income for this coming year. And then finally, there are the leases for offshore wind, which are long-term factor. So those are there. And I think I would say generally that we see our role in, you know, what I've just explained and looking at these numbers is really just to highlight them. Because in a sense, we're not the experts on them. The Scottish Government is the expert going on. And that's so I would recommend you, as you said, you really ask them more of this than us. So I think we're the sort of messenger in this case, that we wanted to highlight that this rather large amount of funding has, you know, and these are the sources that we've been told where they've come from. And, you know, and I think that's a question I'd raise with them, is that's really as far as our message has gone, is to say that this is going on in the background, which I think historically may not have, you know, become so public. So I think we're quite pleased that we'd be able to highlight them as an issue, and because I think the more the transparent the budget becomes, the better. So, but we're still clearly not the experts in any of these four elements.
So I can sense you're laughing. I apologise if that was an unfair question, but we will be following it up with the Cabinet Secretary then. So, and are you confirming then that the specific amounts, as my understanding at the moment in terms of the health and social care levy, the UK Treasury is saying that they are included in Barnett consequentials, but we don't have a sense of over what exact amount. Is that correct? And is that the assumption you're making as well?
Yeah, I think that is correct. I think one thing I would also highlight about these extra effects is because the way that, you know, it would be nice to be able to say, well, they're a little bit uncertain. We don't quite know the scale of them. So let's be a bit cautious and put in small numbers, you know. But because of the way the fiscal framework works, and we've just discussed this, having too much money coming in the last minute is almost as problematic as having too little money coming in the last minute. And therefore, that's another reason why I think sort of feasible, because you can say, well, you just want to, even though you think this money might arrive, it might also be larger than you say. And unfortunately, extra money, you know, there's no way to put it in the budget. So they've had to make a sort of a shot in the middle of where these numbers are. And that's one of the background issues that the government faces in trying to project these numbers is they can't be cautious. They have to actually aim for the middle on each occasion. But I think Alistair read something.
If I can add just two points. The health and social care levy should be seen as different, distinct from the issue of the £620 million, because the levy itself is a reserve UK tax, and the plans to spend initially on health and in subsequent years on social care by the UK government, will have fed through the Barnett formula like the other effects of the UK budget. So that has come down, that comes down that route, and it's not involved in the 620 million. And the only point I'd add about 620 million to what Francis has already said, when he said that it's good that this is out in the open and able to be discussed, is a good thing. But we also will expect the Scottish, and I expect you as MSPs will expect the Scottish Government to report as the fiscal year proceeds on how this additional how this additional income has materialised, and we will expect in our fiscal updates during the year to keep track of this and keep the Parliament informed.
Thank you very much for that. Just another sort of small question. We were touching earlier on demographics and the reduction in anticipated reduction in immigration. And I appreciate what you'd said, Alistair, earlier, that demographics were a much bigger implication than reduction in immigration. But I just wondered, again, it's in terms of your modelling, do you have any sense of the reduction in the tax take over, you know, if we sum it up to the I think you said 50,000, Susan, what that actual cost to tax take for the UK government? I don't know if you model that at all or you've just done it by numbers, but whoever, I'm not sure who is best to answer that. So,
sorry, could you just repeat it very slightly? The reduction in tax take?
Yeah, what I'm saying
on
is
the back
that
of population change, is that what you're asking? Yeah.
What I'm trying to work out is what sort of number, what's the sort of cost in numerical figures to the Scottish Government in tax take of the reduction of up to 50,000 immigrants? I don't know anything about the nature of how much tax they paid, whether you would average it, but I'm just trying to get a sense of what has the cost been in budgetary terms.
Okay, thank you. Francis, I think you...
Well, I'll start off and then I'll hand over to Alistair. So just say... year-on-year migration numbers don't make a huge difference, because as you saw, those are relatively small. But I think what your question implies, and this is where it gets very difficult, is, you know, migration 20 years ago has an impact on tax take today, and the utility of migrants, you know, is another factor that has an impact on tax take. And we haven't, so in unravelling the migration effect within tax is really very complicated. We haven't. But that's a really excuse saying we haven't done that, because it actually is very difficult to unwind the effects of, you know, migration, because it has such a long, slow impact, and it impacts the whole structure of the labour force very slowly, but obviously builds up to be quite a large factor over long periods.
Okay, thank you. Can
you... Okay, thank you very much. I want to thank the Scottish Fiscal Commission for their evidence today and for producing such an excellent and detailed report. That concludes this section of our evidence taking. We shall reassemble at 11:37. Thank you. For our second panel on the Scottish Budget 2022-23, we are joined by David Iser, Senior Knowledge Exchange Fellow, Fraser Valder Institute, and Professor Graham Roy, Dean of External Engagement and Professor of Economics, College of Social Sciences, University of Glasgow. I welcome you both to the meeting, and can again remind members and witnesses that our broadcasting team will operate the microphones. We have up to 90 minutes for this session. Before I open up the discussion, can I ask Professor Roy to start us off with some opening remarks? Professor Roy?
Great. Thank you very much, Convener, and thank you very much for the opportunity to come through and give evidence today. I just want to make three brief points that jumped out from me from the budget, and obviously much of the debate, as usual, will get focused on our budget lines going up or down, what's happening to income tax thresholds, etc. But I think if we take a step back, then there's some interesting reflections which were picked up in the earlier discussion that I joined at the end there, just about the overall trend in public finances in Scotland, which I think are really crucial. And some of these, as we discussed with the Fiscal Commission earlier, have huge uncertainties. But I think discussing the overall trends and thinking about what they might mean for public services and the public finances going forward are really important. I think the first thing is the conversation that you just had about the relative economic performance between Scotland and the rest of the UK. And that's something that has been in the system, so actually in the numbers that we've seen, not just recently, but since, you know, depending on which way you do it, since the middle of the decade, even back to after the financial crisis, where the Scottish economy on a per capita basis is growing more slowly than the rest of the UK. And the question that I think we've had in previous budgets was, is that temporary or is it something that seems to be more structural? And I think if you look at the numbers again from the Fiscal Commission, then it seems to suggest that there is something more longer term that's driving these numbers. You know, the 3 years of negative income tax reconciliations added to with another 2 years forecast in the next round. We've got the discussion that you just had about the relative tax gap between Scotland between Scottish income tax and the block grant adjustments, which are now negative. And the key thing is what's driving that. So we now understand the technical reasons for that, weaker earnings growth, weaker participation, but actually what is it that is actually driving that? Is it challenges in the North Sea? Is it weaker growth more broadly in the economy? And what can we do, if anything, can we do about that? Or what can this Parliament do about that? So I think that's the first broad thing that I think is important to focus on. I think the second thing gets into the pressures that we're seeing coming through on public spending. So again, just to take the one example around the Social Security, again, this divergence through policy choices, primarily, but between the commitments that we're making on some elements of Social Security and then the block grant adjustments. Now, that's not to say that they're not the right policies to do, but they come with an opportunity cost. And if the tax base is not as growing as strongly as we would perhaps hope it would be, then that means that money is going to have to be found from some other places. Which brings me on to, I guess, the third point, is that the pressures that we see in public spending more broadly. And we obviously know the public service have been under huge pressure through the COVID crisis, particularly in the health budget, big increases there. But are they enough to cope with the legacy effects of this crisis and the reforms and the structural changes that we need in terms of our future health projections? So I guess the key thing that jumps out from all of those questions there is just the importance of the discussion that we had maybe about a month ago around public service reform and the fundamental value that has in managing through this crisis. I think it's really good that the government are now looking to have the spending review next year. And I think the questions that are in there are exactly the right types of questions, like prevention, like greater cross collaboration across government. And for me, that's really where the big focus will have to be over the next couple of years as a parliament, about how do we cope with managing these pressures in the budget through genuine reform that means that we can continue to deliver the public services that we all want and we all depend upon.
Okay, thank you. Now, David, I don't think you wanted to make any opening remarks, but you can if you so wish, no?
Thanks.
Okay, well, thank you very much. We'll go straight to questions, and I'll base my initial questions obviously on the kind of statement that you've just kind of made, Professor Roy. I mean, you basically said, you know, that we have to obviously look at public service reform and we have to be genuine in that reform. And I mean, but the issue, of course, is going to be politically how we bring in genuine reform in terms of prevention and more efficiency and better use of public pound, whether it just being seen as cuts, etc. So that's one thing. So I'm just wondering if you can address how we kind of approach that. The second thing, of course, is the issue about whether or not we do that, and whether we do that or not successful, there still is a real long-term issue, it appears to me, about the sustainability of the public finances and indeed the relative divergence in taxation, tax revenues with the rest of the UK. So in following on from that, and obviously I'll be asking David to comment on these matters as well, what can we do to try and reverse some of the issues in relation to productivity that we have in Scotland? Because if the economy was more productive, if we were 1% more productive a year, for example, than we are now, then I think we wouldn't really be facing this problem for much longer. So how do we actually address these kind of broad issues before we go into the meat and drink of the budget?
Yeah, no, it's great questions. And I think maybe go on the second one first around the economy. And I think one of the things back to when the fiscal framework was signed up and we agreed to have these greater devolution was the acceptance that there's a risk built in here about Scotland's relative economic performance compared to the UK. I think what's been quite striking is over the last, throughout since that tax devolution, that risk has all gone in the negative way, where it's actually been that Scotland's been underperforming relative to the UK as a whole. I think there's a genuine question about what we can do to address that. Is this something which is in the gift of policymakers? Is this something which is in the gift of Scottish policymakers? Is this things that we've got levers that we can change? Or is this actually more structural changes that are in our economy? We heard earlier about demographics. We heard earlier about the decline in the North Sea. These are areas it's very difficult for policymakers to take a different choice there. That the North Sea is something which is naturally going to decline as a major economic sector in Scotland. You can do things to try and replace that with the growth of renewables, etc. But there's a big fundamental structural change in the Scottish economy that is, I think we have to recognise, and we have to recognise it is going to always be there. So then you need to think, well, where can we make a difference? And where can we make a difference in terms of boosting productivity and what are the potential options there? And obviously the government will be publishing shortly their next economic strategy for economic transformation. And I think there are questions about how we can become more productive as a country around linking about our skills gaps, so where there's potential skills mismatches in our economy. Focus as well on, typically when we look at productivity, we always think of productivity being right at the top end, so how we can become more productive in terms of having the best performing companies. But if you look at all the evidence, one of the things that we see in Scotland is that our core business base is just naturally less productive, less entrepreneur and less innovative than many of our key competitors. So what can we do to shift the dial in that core business base to become more productive? And that's less about the next generation of new technologies, but actually about being able to use existing technologies better. So what can we do to boost the overall core skills base, digital base of our economy? And then just quickly on your first point about the spending review and the challenges around cuts, as we discussed that 4 weeks ago, it's really hard. But there is, I think, as we discussed then, the Christie Commission was a point in time where the Independent Budget Review was saying that these things were going to happen. I think you jump forward 10 years, these things are now happening. The pressures on public services, the challenges around demographics, they're now here. And I think that it is the opportunity to really have a really significant review of how public services are delivered and what we can do to do what the government is talking about through greater collaboration, reform, prevention, etc. That will involve difficult choices, but I guess that's ultimately what the government have to do in order to make the public finances sustainable.
Hey, thanks. I mean, obviously you've touched on demographics, and there was a lot of discussion in the previous session about that, indeed our private session earlier on. So David, just touching on that, I mean, obviously I'd be happy for you to respond to any of the kind of points that are raised already, but we discussed, for example, immigration, you know, down perhaps because of Brexit, birth rate down, even the number of younger people who are in tertiary education. But we're still in Scotland at a time of a high number of vacancies, a record number of vacancies, have around 100,000 people, with, you know, roughly around 4.5% of the population unemployed. And clearly, if these people were in productive employment, you know, then that itself would make a difference. So what can we do in terms of trying to upskill these people to improve market participation and reverse some of these kind of trends that we can see at the moment?
I mean, I think you're right to highlight that although, it's the unemployment rate at the moment is actually, I think, remarkably low considering where we were a year ago. And we were, you know, most forecasters were expecting that we might be looking at an unemployment rate of 7, 8, 9% now. And the fact that the economy has recovered so much more quickly than anyone was forecasting this time last year is remarkable, and it obviously reflects the success of the vaccine programs, the success of the economic support measures that have been in place during the pandemic. But you're right that one of the reasons why unemployment has actually remained low is that inactivity has increased. It's higher than it was amongst the young, and that's partly because of an increase in educational participation, but it's also increased among some of the older age groups as well. And, you know, to a large extent, I think this does reflect, of course, the fact that we're still very much in the early stages of this recovery, and the economy is going through this sort of structural shift. And although the economy as a whole is expected to be back at pre-pandemic levels in the second quarter of next year, for some sectors, they're not expected to get back to pre-pandemic levels for a significant time after that, for obvious reasons. And we can all see that as we go about our daily lives. So there is a role for the public sector to support this transition to a new economy, to a different sort of structural makeup, if you like. And I think the government's actually doing a lot of the things already that it should be doing in terms of a focus on employability and on skills. We go back to that question of, you know, are we doing enough to ensure that we're capturing the outcomes of that activity, that activity is delivering the sorts of outcomes that that we want, and those are difficult questions. But the stated aim of the spending review is to get to grips with those issues and to plan spending policy on the basis of an evidence-based and outcomes-based approach. And that's certainly on paper, that's the right thing to be doing.
I mean, David, one of the issues obviously that we have with this budget is the plethora of different figures that you've actually seen. So for example, you know, we have a situation whereby the Scottish Government is saying one thing in terms of figures, the Scottish Fiscal Commission is saying something slightly different, and of course the UK Government is probably saying something different depending whether or not COVID figures are included. Where does the Fraser of Alden Institute and indeed, you know, Graham, yourself, where do you stand in terms of the kind of figures that we're actually dealing with? Because what we have on page 2 of the document, the budget document you've seen, is the Scottish Government saying in practical terms between 2021 and 22 and 22-23, and I think the key words are in practical terms, resource funding is 7.1% in less than real terms. And they also go on to say, which appears to be less controversial from the figures that we've been presented with by others, the equivalent reduction for Scotland's capital budget grant funding is a 9.7% real terms cut between 21-22 and 22-23. So where do you feel we are in that? And how could, because obviously when we're trying to scrutinise the budget, we have to look at these figures and see, well, where actually are we and what room for manoeuvre does the Scottish Government actually have?
So I do think it makes sense to focus on the block grant from the UK government, because that remains the key determinant of the Scottish government's overall spending envelope. Obviously, the last 2 years have been exceptional because of the pandemic, and they've, as a result, been exceptional fiscally. With the Scottish government receiving around 8.6 billion in 2021 of COVID funding and 4.9 billion in 21-22 of COVID funding from the UK government on top of the usual core block grant. Now, that COVID funding drops out of the equation in 22-23, and what we're left with is a core block grant that is significantly higher than it was pre-pandemic, about 8% in real terms higher than pre-pandemic, but an overall level of resource from the UK government that's 7% lower in 22-23 than it was in 21-22. So those two figures are they're factually correct. There are the two comparisons you could make. I mean, in some ways, neither of them are all that helpful because, I mean, it's all very well to say that the core block grant is 8% higher than pre-pandemic, but of course the pandemic continues to have a substantial legacy on public services. And so, you know, in itself, quite how meaningful is that? Not entirely sure. On the other hand, to say that the total block grant is 7% lower in 22-23 than it was in 21-22 is perhaps not all that helpful either, because we all at least hope at the moment that 22-23 is going to be a year in which the direct impacts of the pandemic on public services are significantly less than they were in 21-22. So I think, you know, there are different comparisons that you can make. There are always different comparisons you can make. But I think the undeniable point is that in the context of the priorities, the commitments that the government has set, and in terms of the legacy of the pandemic on public services, it's a challenging outlook for the budget. And in fact, the following 2 years, when the resource block grant is effectively flat in real terms relative to the 22-23 level, that outlook becomes even more challenging. So I do think it's a challenging outlook. There are, of course, different numbers in the SFC's document, and that's because, as John Ireland pointed out in the previous session, they're not just looking at the resource from the UK government, but various other things. So they're including, for example, around 400 million drawdown from the Scotland Reserve in 21-22, which boosts spending in 21-22, but at the moment there are no plans to draw down in 22-23. I suspect that will change. They're also including the government's assumption, the Scottish government's assumption, that additional resources will come from the UK government in the early part of 22-23. So that also boosts Scottish government spending in 22-23. And the other thing that's material here as well is the non-domestic rates and the rollback of the non-domestic rates reliefs in 22-23, which obviously also contributes to additional spending in 22-23 relative to 21-22.
Okay, thanks. Just before you come in, Graham, I mean, you know, David touched on it there. He talked about the Fiscal Commission. They kind of sit halfway between the Scottish Government and the UK Government's assessment of these figures. So basically, you know, they say in paragraph 9 that the overall Scottish budget will be 2.6% lower in 22-23 than in the current year, 5.2%, allowing for inflation. And of course, one of the issues, of course, is, well, as David touched on, is that means they have to that includes like drawing down of resources, etc. What's the implications in terms of the long-term fiscal sustainability of Scottish finances, given the kind of you know, the kind of the fiscal framework which we have to work within, and which has become, through inflation, etc., becoming increasingly tight as we progress?
So I think, I mean, so David's run through the numbers, and I think, again, we have this at every budget. There's a ding dong about whether the budget's going up or down. What's the size of that? I think that's now become, it's like Christmas every year. It happens, and we kind of move on. And I think if you're taking a step back, the big question is exactly the point you made there. The budget is, I think we can all agree, the budget settlement is tight. Whether that means there's a marginal increase or a marginal decrease, I think we can agree that the budget settlement is tight, with additional pressures because of things like inflation. So inflation potentially going to be much higher this year than it has been historically, which puts huge pressure on wages. So even if you have, in relative previous, a relatively generous increase in public sector wages, it's likely to be a real terms cut for most people because of inflation in there. So you add in inflation, and that builds in challenges. You then add in the stuff we've spoken about already about the challenges in the tax revenues and things like that, and then you build in the wider public spending pressures. I think if we can agree on one thing, I think it's a challenging settlement. What the exact number looks like, that then I think, you know, you can debate that all day, and I don't think you'll get anyone to, everyone will stick to their fixed position, but I think the general point that you make is really important.
we as a committee are trying to take, you know, trying to cut through a lot of the, and it's not exactly easy, but to cut through some of the politics, at least to try and get a consensual approach if possible on that. I mean, one of the things that I'd be keener to try and get some more information from either of you, Graham, perhaps, kind of the first go, is this legendary £620 million, which is the annex A of the document, but it's not really spelled out in precise terms as to how we get to this £620 million and how likely that money will be delivered. Of course, the Scottish Fiscal Commission have said that they think it's reasonable to assume that, but you know, there's a difference between reasonable and whether or not the money will actually arrive, and of course it does have implications. So I'm just wondering if you can say something about that, then Graham, and then yourself, David. And then Daniel wants to come in with a related question.
I mean, David might know more about the detail on it, but I think it did jump out as being quite a significant addition into the budget. And again, just listening to the Fiscal Commission and reading the report, it doesn't go into the detail about exactly what makes up that 620. So what's the components of that? All the explanations make sense around, obviously, there's this personal allowance resolution due. It might be due this year, it might be slightly later than that, which might lead to additional funding flowing to the Scottish Government if the Scottish Government are successful in their challenge around the fiscal framework and no detriment. There's obviously the potential for another fiscal event between now and the start of next year, so early next year, so around March time, you'll have another UK budget or spring budget, which might bring additional Barnett consequentials, and the government are obviously making an assessment about what that could be. And I think the other point that I think the Fiscal Commission made quite well there is that the nature of this framework and the way it works, actually the Scottish Government is right to have an overestimate of that, because anything that underestimate then potentially leads to challenges around how it manages its budget. So actually having a relatively generous assessment for that probably makes sense from a technical point of view. The key point is, if this money doesn't flow through, then that's additional pressures that are going to have to be found from within portfolios in order to make up the demand there. But David might know a bit more about the breakdown of what's in the 620.
I'm still struggling to find the table, but I know I have seen it. But I mean, I think my view on this is we know from past budgets that it's almost inevitable that there will be some additional resources of at least several hundred million pounds that flow through to the budget for 22-23 because of additional UK government spending that might come at main estimates, that might come at the March budget. And in that context, well, the Scottish government's kind of got a couple of options about what it does. It can kind of assume that it's not going to happen, and when those additional resources are confirmed, it can then decide at a later point what it's going to do with those additional resources and announce that as part of the spring budget revisions, or it can make an assumption and factor it into its budget plans. Given that it seems inevitable that at least several hundred million additional will be confirmed, that's just our experience of recent years, it's prudent to factor it into the budget. It seems to me that probably results arguably in the money being used more strategically and subject to greater scrutiny than if it's sort of dealt with at spring budget revisions.
But more a 2-1 on short than a 2-1 against, so yeah. To speak. Okay, Dan's been followed by Liz.
So I wanted to start by following up with David, about this point around, is it, you know, 7-point-something% up or 7-point-something% down? And confound you both by saying that I can recognise both figures and not be rigid about my view on it. I recognise that the total figure, because of COVID, there was approximately £5 billion of resource funding in the current financial year. But to my mind, the key point is this, is throughout the sort of debate around COVID spend, both publicly and indeed privately, the government have been pretty clear, is that money cannot be used for non-recurring budget items. So if you were to, and I think we can all accept that COVID hasn't completely gone away, so that you know the costs you incur have not disappeared, and therefore that's where you end up in that fuzzy middle position. But is there an issue here around transparency and about the clarity, both in terms of how that $5 billion has been allocated and whether it has been allocated, strictly speaking, on non-recurring COVID items? And indeed, what in the current budget is COVID? Because I think this budget is particularly difficult to track. And I think you see a number of items jumping between line items, and it's not entirely clear what in the budget just presented is directed at COVID. Is that a fair assessment of why we find ourselves in this position?
I mean, I agree that tracking things in budget documents is always challenging. And especially when, I mean, of course, when the 21-22 budget was set, at that point, the government didn't have $4.9 billion of COVID consequentials. It had significantly less than that. So a large chunk of that $4.9 or $5 billion has come during the year and been allocated in year. So that all adds significantly to the challenges there. But I do think it was always going to be the case, and Audit Scotland has talked about this and sort of flagged this up on a number of occasions, that as we moved in time away from the pandemic, making a distinction between what is pandemic spending and not pandemic spending was going to be sort of increasingly blurred. You can see as an example of that is health spending and the substantial increase in the core health budget in this year, well, in 22-23. And how would you disentangle, you know, what of that is because of the legacy of the pandemic from, you know, the underlying pressures that were there all along, I think would be... I'm not sure how helpful it would be to try to do that. So I don't know if that answers your question, but I mean...
It does, although that's quite useful in and of itself, in that we know what the increase in health spending is, about $2 billion. So to my mind, that means there's about $2 billion to find elsewhere. And if the government are basically saying, and it's not unreasonable for them to say it, that we still got ongoing costs from COVID across the board, you know, then it should be more straightforward to identify that in non-health budget lines, but it's not entirely clear where that is in the budget outside of health.
Sorry, you mean it's not clear where the resource for the $2 billion uplift in the health budget has come from?
I think that's quite relatively straightforward. We see the increase, and we know what the consequentials are in terms of health.
Yeah.
But if you're to say that essentially it's a 7% cut, you need to be saying that basically we've still got all of that COVID cost, and that extends beyond health. And therefore, in terms of that delta, there's sort of $1 billion to $2 billion to be found in other budget lines that are essentially legacy COVID spend, and it's not clear what that is.
I agree. It's very hard to track individual budget lines and the consequences of the change in the overall resource settlement for those individual budget lines. And you know, to an extent, that's always the case. To an extent, it's magnified this year because if you compare budget to budget, you're sort of ignoring the large chunk of the COVID funding that's been allocated in year this year.
Thank you. I don't know, Graham, if you want to add
nothing
anything.
Really much more to add, other than I think the fact that you're right, you know, budget documents and the budget information are not really designed to go into that, down to that level in that significant way. The second thing I would say as well is that you can probably think of the areas which are quite clearly a COVID cost. So, you know, lateral flow tests, boosters, it's quite obvious what that is. Non-domestic rates extension, I mean, that is clearly related to COVID, but is extending into next year. But that's not COVID funding, that's Barnett consequentials coming through, which are giving the Scottish Government the opportunity to do that. So I understand your frustration, and I think there is potentially some areas where there could be greater clarity, but in other areas there's just going to be naturally grey areas and all of that. I think there's a more general point, if I can just come quickly, I think there's a general point which builds on the convener's question and your question there as well, around levels of understanding, complexities and ability to do scrutiny of the budget. It's exceptionally complex, and the stuff that we've done just recently on the research on this and just how difficult it is for people to understand and work the way through all of this, I think that's something which we need to get better at collectively as Parliament, Government and others, about what more we can do to make it more accessible in the information and understanding the differences in the lines. Because I think everybody's right in what they produce. What's missing is somebody to then come in along and say, well, this is why you're getting, pull it all together, this is why you're getting the different results here and there.
And I'd argue it's also important for government so they can just manage. moving on, I just, again, continuing on from a line of questioning from the convener, the Fiscal Commission document is important in terms of giving a more medium-term outlook in terms of fiscal pressures. On the one hand, I think we were all surprised by the pessimistic outlook in terms of tax and the implications, but the other is the potential growth in social security spending. And I just really wanted to test the bit of logic I put in front of them. Is if you take those broad assumptions, and I freely accept that these are forecasts and therefore liable to error, but if you look at the net tax position of kind of a negative consequence of around 355 million, coupled with a growth of around 764 million, both in terms of additional and new social security spend. Is there essentially a deficit of around £1 billion that will need to be addressed over the next 4 to 5 years in the Scottish budget?
Go first. So there's no deficit in the sense that the Scottish Government doesn't run a deficit, yeah.
But a challenge.
Yeah, opportunity cost, I think, is the way I would describe it. So what else could you be doing with that money? So a couple of things. I think the income tax situation is concerning. It comes back to the earlier point I was making around the growth in the tax base and the relative economic performance. And not just... it's Scotland's economic performance, but relative to the UK. So the fact that the UK is growing much faster, which is an issue, and that was always built into this fiscal framework. It wasn't just how Scotland did, it was how the rest of the UK did. And if it's got London flat out, then we are struggling to keep up with that. So there is an issue in there, and that leads to this negative tax position. I think the interesting thing, though, as well, is there was a technical point there about one of the commissioners was making around the assumptions that they use about what happens to future tax policy, and the fact that the UK is freezing its thresholds means that you've got to take some of these numbers in terms of the exact specifics of it with a bit of caution, because if the Scottish Government chooses to freeze the thresholds as well, then that will have implications for the specifics of the numbers in there. But the general point is that the net tax position is negative. I think on the social security thing, if you look again at the breakdown, there's issues about how the block grant adjustment works in there. But I think the Fiscal Commission have a quite helpful table in decomposing that into differences by the block grant and then differences by discretionary choices. And it's the discretionary choices which are driving quite a lot of that. That's not to say they're not the right choices, but with a fixed budget, that brings an opportunity cost that you then have to find somewhere else.
Would you agree with that, David? Am I getting the right numbers? I mean, that was the other bit. I don't...
I certainly agree. This is... clearly, the fact that the Scottish Government is... setting a distinctive policy on the new social security levers that it has, the adult and child disability payments, and is rolling out the Scottish Child Payment. I mean, that's, I think, clearly a great illustration of the benefits of devolution, but these policy choices in this case come with cost implications, and that would, on the basis of these forecasts, the the implication is that spending on other things will be 700 million or so lower than it would otherwise have been. So that is going to add to the medium-term challenges, undoubtedly. And then the income tax situation, again, taking the current forecasts as given, that is an additional constraint on the budget.
Thank you. My final question is just coming on to the point that, Graham, I think you raised and really interesting points around kind of Scotland's relative economic performance, and that in a sense drives all of this. And you know, perhaps in my oversimplification kind of rules of thumb in my head, I've always assumed Scotland will do a little bit, you know, less well than London in the southeast, but better than pretty much the rest of the UK. This analysis would seem to suggest that's not correct anymore, and that we're actually trailing most of the rest of the UK. And in particular, I mean, I've always again assumed that Scotland isn't that different to certain other parts of the UK, you know, whether that's the southwest in some ways or the northeast in different ways. So what is it that's particular about Scotland in terms of the lower participation and slower growth in income tax? And can you just go a little bit further into the, you know, why are our companies, you said something really interesting about our companies being less productive. I mean, what's driving that? You were suggesting that we've not been as good at adopting technology and things like that. Could you just go into a bit more detail, because I'm really interested in that latter point.
So, I mean, I think the framing of your question is correct in that if you look at Scotland's level of economic performance in comparison to other parts of the UK, then typically Scotland is third behind London in the southeast, and that's been sustained over a significant period of time because of core strengths in our economy, like financial services, like highly skilled workforce, and like the North Sea. And then also as well, Scotland, like the rest of the UK, has been boosted by inflow of migration from the European Union in the early 2000s, which in turn helped support the Scottish economy. So the starting point has been that that's where Scotland would normally sit relative to other parts of the UK and then the UK as a whole. So pretty much not that far away from the UK average, but third behind London South East, once you account for the huge regional inequalities in the UK. I think what we've seen over the last, since the financial crisis, is that that from that base, the relative performance, the relative growth of the Scottish economy, particularly on a per head basis, but also in a total basis as well, has been slower than the UK as a whole. The Fiscal Commission talk about the potential reasons for that, and it's hard to disagree with that, around issues around demographics in terms of participation. Now, we're protected from raw demographics because of the block grant adjustment, but if the participation for older workers is slightly different, then you will have an impact on that. But then there's also the North East, and again, there's some interesting charts in the Fiscal Commission's report about what's been happening to PAYE numbers and also average earnings in the North East. And that's been a huge part of Scotland's economy for 50 years. It was our largest industrial sector in terms of output for decades. So as you go through that transition and as you go through that entering its twilight time, that is something which is unique to the Scottish economy. It's in the UK economy, but it's a fraction. So if it's 10% of the Scottish economy, it's 1% of the UK economy. So that relative importance of that means that there's a much bigger impact on the Scottish economy. And crucially as well, jobs in the energy sector tend to be higher paid. So again, there's an additional issue on the income tax, because income tax tends to be paid by the higher earners. And stuff about productivity, I mean, you can go into that all day and things, but there's an interesting report from the Productivity Institute just a couple of weeks ago, which is an initiative across the UK looking at productivity, and it's starting to unpick some of these issues. And it is one of the things that that is quite noticeable. Scotland does well on productivity because of our sectoral mix, because we have high productivity sectors like financial services, like energy, and that boosts our productivity. But if you move away from that and look at the core business base across other parts of our economy, our average productivity, our average take-up of innovation, entrepreneurship is lower than the UK. Look at our average spending at research and development. It's lower than many other parts of the UK
look at business investment, it's lower. And I think that's one of the really interesting things I think about from an economic point of view, is that quite often we look at the star companies and the big, you know, what can we do to attract more life sciences or more inward investment into the country? But thinking about what our core business base is like, the basics of connectivity, of access to digital skills, of flexible working, of good management practices in businesses, these are the sorts of things that if you can shift a dial in them, you can actually shift a larger business base. You're not talking about radically transforming and creating gazelle companies and the next Skyscanner, but what you're doing is just gradually shifting the core productive base of your economy. And that's where there's a potential, for, not just for Scotland, but it's an issue if you look at UK comparisons to other parts of the world too.
That's fascinating. I think we need a committee session just on that topic. But David, I don't know if you've got anything to add.
Not really. I mean, it's clear that since income tax devolution started in 2017-18, Scottish earnings growth has been slightly lower than the rest of the UK. It was only, I think, it was only modestly slower in those, you know, in 17-18, 18-19, and 19-20. The latest forecasts sort of seem to imply that that divergence is going to increase in 22-23 in the subsequent years. And, you know, if you were looking on the bright side here, or trying to find a way to look on the bright side here, you might say, well, part of the reason for this divergence in the forecast is because the SFC and the OBR are taking a slightly different view about how inflation will feed through into earnings growth, and probably in reality the way that inflation feeds through into earnings growth won't be as substantially different between Scotland and the rest of the UK as the forecasts currently imply, and it doesn't really matter whether it turns out that the OBR is being a bit optimistic for the UK at the moment, or the SFC is being a bit pessimistic for Scotland at the moment. If they end up being a bit closer, then the outlook won't be quite as bad. But I wouldn't want to alter the conclusion that it's clearly not a particularly great outlook for Scotland. And even if what I'm saying does come to fruition, that's not going to change this fundamental outlook, which is not particularly positive in terms of income tax revenues.
Okay. Thank you.
Lesson followed by John.
Thank you. And just following on from that point, if we do assume that the main challenges to address this problem about declining tax revenues as a proportionate share, am I right in thinking that you're both suggesting that the policies that are required to deal with that challenge are not just the fairly straightforward fiscal policies about whether you increase tax and whether you change thresholds, but actually policies that are going to aim at addressing some of the structural problems within the Scottish economy? Is that fair to say that?
it's certainly not a case that this is something that you can rectify by changing income tax policy. It is much more fundamental than that. I think the sorts of policies that will change this outlook are incredible. You know, there's no obvious answer. If there was an obvious answer, of course, we would all be jumping up and down and saying, here's the answer. It is fundamentally very difficult for any government to change the outlook for productivity and earnings in the short run. I mean, that's at the heart of this. This is not a straightforward thing to address through any policy.
Largely because one of the issues that has been flagged up, well, certainly today, but previously as well, is this difficulty that we have an ageing population and the working population, which is obviously those who are paying the tax, as a proportion is shrinking. And that's not something that somebody can change overnight. And therefore, that leads to the question about whether there are other policies that we have to do to try to compensate what is a projected, you know, you've both said today, as did the Fiscal Commission, that, you know, the outlook's not great. And what I'm trying to get at is, you know, where do we think our best chances in terms of policies that will try to address the difficulties and the potential deficits that we have? That's really the main question, which I'll ask the Cabinet Secretary as well. But I'm just interested from what you think the evidence shows.
Well, I think, as I said, it's very difficult to say, you know, here's a list of three or four policies that you can do that will inevitably close this gap. I mean, some of the things that we've been talking about as the explanations why average earnings growth in Scotland has been slower than in the rest of the UK, and that's the key sort of issue here. It's the relative performance that matters. I mean, some of those things are very clearly linked, I think, to developments in the offshore sector and the way that those, as Graham was talking about, have a more direct impact on the Scottish income tax base than on the rest of the UK income tax base. And it's not, you know, immediately obvious to see how you undo that in a short space of time.
And Professor Roy, you made some extremely interesting points about the productivity and how in some cases Scotland does very well, but in other cases we don't. And just relating that to the concerns that we have about employment trends within the Scottish economy, do you think we have to do more to use employment policies to try to get around some of these difficult structural issues?
And what would you suggest around employment policies? Because I think, as David mentioned, unemployment is less of an issue than it was. It's more about the questions, I think, are more subtle around underemployment, skills gaps, skills mismatches. It's those areas which I think are probably the...
Thinking about two things in particular. I mean, it's quite clear that there are people able to work, but perhaps not able and willing to work in certain jobs. And that's why the vacancy rate has stayed higher than perhaps we might have been expecting at a time where unemployment was supposed to rise. So I think there is this mismatch of skills, and therefore maybe we need policies that will address that. But do we also need policies on the education front that allow younger people in particular to have a wider number of skills to be more flexible in the jobs that they can do, rather than, you know, we've seen increasing flexibility over the years, but are we at a stage where we've got sufficient flexibility to fill some of the gaps?
So I think all of that, I think, is something which is, I think, is really interesting and worth looking at in terms of incentives into work. So that's why things like living wage are actually really important, because it's not just an important thing to do, but it's actually, evidence suggests, actually encourage people to go into work, boost productivity through that way. So things like that are important. I think the wider question about skills and education is really interesting around the balance between skills and balance between education for the workforce and the labour market that we know is coming down in the future. So, like my generation coming through, the idea was that you studied at school, you went to university, that gave you your education, that gave you your skill, and that was it. Whereas the labour market now is much more dynamic, much more flexible. People are probably going to have to be retrained and skilled on a much more regular basis. And are we set up for that? So how easy is it for somebody who is in a job to go and be retrained and be reskilled? How affordable is it? How are you able to do it along with your existing work commitments and caring commitments? Is it accessible that people can reskill and retrain? And how do you do these skills gaps and skills mismatches? So I think there's some really interesting things that are worth looking at in that context there about how you get the labour market much more dynamic. Just building on the more general point there about what policies we can do in all of this. I mean, there's a fiscal policy. We obviously have some tax powers, and there's a debate about whether increasing tax or decreasing tax is good or bad. But of course, increasing tax means you can spend more in these things that help boost productivity. So it's not as easy as simply saying increased tax is bad, decreased tax is good, because you can actually invest it correctly. I think the wider point that we've spoken about is these huge structural pressures that are in Scotland's economy around the demographics, around transitioning from oil and gas and moving into new industries. And we've seen it before around, you know, these big structural changes that happen in our economy, and they create legacy effects, and you see it across the UK and all of that. And I think there's just a word of caution I would say is that policymakers can do things at the margins. You can make differences at the margin, but there are these big structural changes that are happening, which is then, I think, large about adapting to it as much as is what you can do to try and think that you can counter them all easily.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. John, to be followed by Ross.
Hey, thanks, convener. I guess following on some of these issues that have already been touched on, particularly maybe David, I could start. Spice produced a report which I quoted at the last session, I don't know if you saw that, about the GDP growth rates in the calendar years coming up, and Fraser Valander were at 4.8, which I think was made in September, whereas Scottish Fiscal Commission 3.8 in December. So that's within Scotland just, and then we've got the OBR at 6, and generally at a UK level, the OBR appears to be at the highest end, higher than the Bank of England, for example. I mean, have you any thoughts around that, apart from what you've already said?
Well, I think there clearly is and has been a lot of uncertainty around the outlook for the economy. I mean, and that was true even before anyone had heard of Omicron. So despite the much stronger than forecast economic performance during 2021, which I mentioned earlier, there were big uncertainties for 2022 around things like the outlook for inflation and how that might impact things. There were uncertainties about what we'll see in terms of business investment. There were uncertainties around this issue that we've been talking about in terms of reallocation of the economy to a slightly different configuration and how quickly that would happen. So I think all forecasters have been very open about saying there's greater than usual uncertainty about their forecasts. So there is inevitably some variation around that. And of course, the uncertainty has increased in the last couple of weeks.
You said earlier that in one sense, and I get this, that if the OBR is being a bit optimistic and the SFC is being a bit pessimistic, it will come out in the wash in a few years' time. I think the problem, that's not exactly what you said, but I think roughly. The problem for us is that in the short term, in the next 1, 2, 3 years, these forecasts affect our budget. And so we could end up, you know, having to make savings that actually in the wash, you know, hopefully that won't happen in the long run, and it would recover. So, I mean, there is a problem if one's cautious and one's optimistic, is there not?
Well, there is a problem if one's cautious and one is optimistic. But in a way, if that is what's happening and it does all come out in the wash, that's a much more preferable situation to be in than one where actually the forecasters have got things right and there are these big structural differences in the performance of the economies and it doesn't come out in the wash. So if it does come out in the wash, that's the sort of the best outlook that there is at the moment.
In short-term pain for long-term gain kind of thing.
Yes, I mean, there would be, so if it does turn out that in 22, 23, things have been much better in Scotland than is forecast, or much worse in the UK than is forecast, that there'd be a positive reconciliation on income tax in a future year, and there would be a transfer of resources over time. That's right, but it would be a transfer of resources over time. But as I say, that's probably, you know, a preferable outcome than one where the current set of forecasts are a good reflection of what actually arises, and there isn't then any positive reconciliation further down the line.
Yeah, okay. I mean, Graeme Roy, I was interested in what you said about, you know, differentiating between what we can change and what we can't change. And, I mean, also some of the stuff around productivity. Now, some of that's probably more of the work of the Economy Committee, I suspect. I think Michelle Thompson's on that committee. Where we're going with that, because, I mean, I still wonder about the productivity thing. For example, you know, if we put two people on a train, two crew on a train, that is less productive than one person on a train, but it increases safety and we get the fares collected and all these things. So, I mean, it seems to me that productivity isn't always an issue. And, I mean, with tourism, is that a sector where it's harder to have productivity because a good hotel has more staff and looks after the people better? I'm not sure. But I suppose where I'm going with this then is population. Now, in one sense, that's something we can't control, but on the other hand, with immigration, we could control it. I mean, I'm just wondering, out of all these issues we're talking about, productivity, skills, population, is the biggest one the population? Is that really what's holding us back?
So I've not done any modelling on what would be the relative difference between the two. What I would say is that population is not the quick... is not a quick fix unless you can get migration, and it's something that beds through. So the challenges Scotland have got about the population are decades old. It goes way back to the differentials between what happened in the mid-20th century between Scotland and the rest of the UK in terms of our population flows. So and that's just coming through. And so these are things that are decades in the making rather than something that is short term. I think on the productivity, and I didn't mean to set the discussion away into a big discussion about productivity, but I think you hit the nail on the head about, you know, productivity isn't everything, but it's a crucial way to boost wages, which for this fiscal framework, whether you agree or disagree with economic growth or whatever, in this framework, the framework that's been signed up to, what matters is the ability to get earnings growing, essentially get earnings growing and employment growing at the same rate as the UK, roughly speaking. So it's crucial for this framework. Now, you may disagree with that, but for this framework, that's absolutely fundamental to it. But the other point that you made that is really important as well is that productivity is not just about volume. It's not about doing more stuff. It's doing better quality stuff. And that's where an economy like Scotland has got the potential to focus on. So it's better quality jobs. It's better quality products and activities rather than simply volume. And that's where I think, and sometimes in the past, the conversations get too lost in a technical discussion about productivity. But if you focus on doing more and actually potentially even working, you know, smarter, it's not about working more, it's about working smarter, using things more efficiently to create better quality things. That's where an economy like Scotland is a potential to be a comparative advantage. Now, that doesn't say there's not a wider discussion about whether growth is good or growth is bad, but for this framework, that's ultimately what matters in terms of whether the relative tax revenue is in our favour or not.
I realise you are in a university, and you said earlier on that, you know, there was this assumption, which was absolutely the case when I was younger, that if I went to university, I'd get a good job, and that'd be me for life. Yes, well, that's right. You know, I think the schools are still thinking that way in a sense, and I made the comparison earlier, I don't want to get too into personal details, but, you know, one of my nephews has gone to university and will take some time to earn wages. The other one hasn't and is earning very good wages now. So in the short term, that helps tax, that helps. You know, are we emphasising universities and academic qualifications too much at the expense of practical apprenticeships, even engineering, some of these things?
So I'm not an education specialist, so I can't really comment too much in detail on that. All right. And in some ways, I don't always think it's maybe doing kind of less than that. But I think it's about what I would say is if we take a step back and look forward to the changing nature of our labour market, how do we provide that flexibility and that accessibility to education and skills that we need for the labour market? Now, that will still involve significant tertiary education, but it's accessible to colleges. How do we make universities and colleges more accessible to older workers in terms of the ability to access all that expertise and things? And what more can we do out of universities to support innovation and technological change? But I think you're right, there's also a general question about what can we do more to, I think the point earlier about provide support for young people to enter into the labour market, to give them the skills and to give them the experience, I think is ultimately really important too. So I know I've not answered your question specifically, but that might be something you want to follow up.
And if I can just have a final point, I don't think we've said very much in this session about capital expenditure. I mean, we seem to be coming to a kind of limit with how much we can borrow for capital expenditure, which is £3 billion. Does that, if we have to cut back on capital expenditure, is that going to have a real hit on growth in the economy?
David? I think investment spending, capital spending is an important component of growth in the long run, clearly, and not just public sector capital investment, but private sector investment as well. With capital spending, it's the same story as with resource spending. I mean, the block grant, the capital block grant from the UK government is the key thing that influences what the Scottish government can do, and you can argue about whether the UK government should be being more expansive on capital spending or not. But in effect, the Scottish government has to sort of play the card it's been given there. And the long-run picture is that over the next few years, the capital budget is relatively high in historic terms, but again is sort of fairly flat over the course of this Parliament. Borrowing powers, the Scottish government's borrowing powers can increase that a bit at the margins. Is there a case for the Scottish government to have higher capital borrowing powers? I think you could probably make the case, and what you could certainly make the case for is that the current limits are fixed in cash terms, the 2016 cash terms levels that were agreed back then. There's no rational explanation for that. At the very least, these limits should be being increased in line with some measure of inflation or some measure of the overall budget. I think there's a very good case for that, so both the annual borrowing limit and the overall cap. Borrowing limits beyond that would be something that the two governments will negotiate in the fiscal framework review next year.
Okay, thanks.
Well, points, is it not the case that capital is declining quite significantly in the next financial year, by about 9.7% in real terms? And just one other point before I let Ross in, is in terms of productivity, is it not one of the issues that much of the Scottish budget is demand-led? You know, people actually, you know, the ageing population, you need more care workers, more people in the NHS, and those are areas where it's harder to actually increase productivity, you know, because a lot of it is very people-focused, very labour-intensive, and you can't just suddenly decide we're going to reduce the number of people that are seen by a certain, you know, doctor, nurse or carer in a shift. It's much more difficult than, for example, increasing productivity through technological change in manufacturing.
So the short answer is yes. And that's why it comes back to my general point about we've got to be careful about how much we think that we can turn the dial in these things, because actually a lot of the stuff is on things which are naturally not going to do it. But also, it comes back to the general point, is that, you know, creating, you know, good, secure work in social care is not about boosting productivity or having a better economy. It's about providing good quality care for people in social care, and we shouldn't lose sight of that. So the point I'm making about productivity is, at the margin, there may be things that you can do, but again, just as you've said there, you've got to take that in the wider context in what the government can and can't control and make a difference on.
David, sorry, you were going to say about capital.
Yes, on the capital spending, my comment was sort of in relation from 2022-23 throughout this Parliament, as far as we know. It's fairly flat in real terms, but you're right that there's a drop from 21-22 into
22-23. Yeah. Ross, sorry, to be followed by Douglas.
Thanks. Just following up on John's point and some of the comments that you were making there, Graham, around the objective of creating a high wage, driving up wages, creating a high wage economy. Do you think in the plethora of economic plans, enterprise strategies, innovation documents, etc., that exist in the Scottish public sector landscape, is there a clear overarching sense of what sectors we're specifically talking about when we're talking about creating a high-wage economy, but where we think we can actually create those kind of jobs. Is there a consistent understanding of what that actually means specifically beyond a very agreeable high-level objective?
I think, as you probably know from stuff that I said in the past when I was at the Fraser Islander, is about that cluttered landscape and that lack of focus in many ways. And I think that that is something which I think we would need more of in Scotland, about being focused about what is it we're trying to achieve and genuinely what are the sectors that we could potentially create value in. And also, what's our relative scale? Because we talk some sectors which are large employment, like social care, like tourism, which might on a technical basis show up as being lower in terms of productivity than something like life sciences, but we employ far fewer people in sectors like that relative to that. We're never going to employ large numbers of people in life sciences. So I take your point about being really laser-like focused upon where are the sectors and where are the opportunities we have to create high-value jobs, but where have we also got the opportunity to create better quality work, fair work more broadly across the economy. And that is not just a way of increasing on the tax revenue side, but it also feeds through to all the other conversations we've had about demand and public services as well.
Thanks. And on another wider point, we're going to be moving pretty quickly in a matter of weeks into discussions around the spending review and the remit of the review. Beyond the obvious overarching question of how do we close this gap between the cost of current spending commitments and the resource that's going to be available, what do you both believe are the questions that we should be asking? What should the remit of the spending review specifically include beyond, again, the obvious, how do we close this significant gap?
So I think, so three quick things I would say for me. So obviously you're right, there's the first question about what's the immediate priorities given the envelope that we have that you might not really be able to shape too much off, because a large amount of it is demand-led, as the convener said. I think if you then look at what the government are identifying as their priorities around, you know, cross-government collaboration, public service reform, better targeting, targeted revenue raising, and the rest of them, I think the thing that's important for me is to separate them out into two elements. So things like prevention and public sector reform that we've spoken about for ages, they are very long term. So the changes that you make now in the spending review that will take place in the spring will not really change the dial over the next few years. But things about greater cross-government collaboration, things like better targeting, things like targeted revenue raising, they are things that you could make more of a progress here. So for me, it's separating these three areas. What are the very long-term things and the difficult things, and have a discussion about them? What are the things you could do now through better efficient and better working that could actually have an impact in the medium term? And then what do you do about the short term in terms of prioritisation?
Thanks. David?
I mean, I would agree with all of that. I think what the government set out as the principles by which it will undertake this review are all very sensible, outcomes-focused, evidence-based, consultative. That all sounds right. Clearly, what the spending review needs to do is to provide certainty about spending over the 2 years following the 22-23 budget. And I think, you know, what I'd expect, therefore, is for the government to set out very clearly what it thinks its overall budget outlook will be, the allocations it's made as part of that, and how this outcomes and evidence-based approach has informed those allocations.
Thanks very much. That's all from me for now, Convener.
Okay. Douglas, to be followed by Michelle.
Thanks, Convener. I just want to talk about North East and the North East, not just because I represent North East, but because, as we mentioned earlier, it's still a significant part of the Scottish economy. I remember the oil price crash back in 2014-16, and, things were, quite grim up in Aberdeen. But, with oil price, we've seen it's recovered. It's in quite a good place. So why is the North Sea economy still holding the Scottish economy back then, if that's, if the oil price is back to where it was?
Do you want me to go first? I can go first. Yeah. So I think there's there's lots of dynamics, as you know, going on in the Northeast about what's happening in the oil and gas industry and the changing nature of the workforce and the changing nature of deployment of oil and gas activities. So that is having an impact within the sector. But as you know, more broadly across the Northeast economy, then the spillovers of that into the Northeast, into the kind of core business activity there, that's not as strong as it has been in the past. And I guess one of my reflections is that that in many ways there's been a lot of churn happening in the Northeast and a lot of churn happening in oil and gas. But typically, if you look over decades, you know, what we're seeing now is the sector moving into its mature phase, which is then feeding through into these longer term trends we're having in employment levels, investment, and overall economic activity. And I think that's where the efforts of the Northeast to try and pivot into other opportunities becomes absolutely crucial. So not just into other forms of energy and hydrogen and carbon capture and the like, but then to broaden out its diversification into other parts of the economy. So the stuff that One do around supporting life sciences, around trying to create more of a digital economy, trying to boost tourism, but focusing on the quality end of the tourism stuff. That's the sort of thing which I think is ultimately is crucial for the Northeast transitioning away from being the oil and gas capital to being more energy capital, but also a more diversified economy. So I think what we're seeing is not something that's happening over years. It's actually it's a decade kind of transition coming through that's showing up in the numbers.
And I guess in terms of policy, you know, we know the decline's coming. It's just about how fast that decline is.
Yeah, and there's obviously big political debates in about that, about how that's managed, what's the balance, what's the trade-off between that and climate change objectives, etc. Again, purely from a technical point of view, in this framework, the importance of kind of high-income jobs across the Scottish economy is absolutely crucial. So looking at this framework, what really matters in the long term, what really matters from a Scottish perspective is getting people who are in high-paid jobs in the Northeast tied to oil and gas that might not be there in 10, 20, 30 years' time into high-paid jobs in other parts of the economy, either in renewable energy or other sources of energy or into the wider economy. And a technical person, that's what's crucial for this framework because of the nature of how it operates.
Okay. David, did you
anything to add?
Other question I had, Convener, is around, you know, prevention and collaboration that you mentioned, Professor Roy. I don't want to be a spokesperson for local government, but when you can see what's happened to the local government budget, you know, I've got a fear that in terms of prevention, that could be impacted by a cut of 2.7% to the local government budget. Is that something that you share as well?
In terms of?
The fear that the prevention agenda can't happen because where local government, that a lot of the prevention takes place, is having its budget so squeezed.
Yeah, I mean, I probably wouldn't say anything specific about local government, whether that their budget settlement is going to make it better, worse than prevention. I think your premise, your overall question around, and this comes back to when the convener, I think the very first question you gave to me around, if you've got a really tight budget settlement, how can you make the changes that let you do prevention? Because that means shifting money from something which is in the here and now into something which is potentially speculative and potentially really long term. And that's really hard to do. And local government's at the front end of that because a lot of what they do is about that prevention there. And I think that's where, for me, if it's helpful in the spending review to try and separate it out and not try and put everything into the pot at once and try and separate it out into what are the changes that we could do now that might make some savings or make better service delivery or efficiencies that will generate relatively quick savings and then continue to have the really thorny, difficult conversations about where do we actually make the changes on prevention that are going to take a very long time. I don't have the answer to that. I mean, we've been talking about this for more than a decade, and we had James Mitchell and the Auditor General talking about this a month or so ago, and we haven't come up with the solutions in the 6 weeks since then. So,
yeah, I think we could talk about it for a long time and still won't find solutions.
Indeed. Thanks, Convener. Well, let's be a bit more optimistic than that. Michelle.
If you're looking for optimism, you've possibly come to the wrong place. I mean, we've covered an awful lot of what I would have wanted to explore in this session. And, you know, sometimes politicians play these games about, well, if it were me, what would I do? And I find myself kind of, oh, you know, there's lots of things I thought, for example, well, we could make all of Scotland a free trade zone. Oh, no. We can't do that. We could attract lots more entrepreneurs into Scotland, going back to the digital link. Oh, no, we can't do that. We could really pick up on George Osborne's old phrase about the kind of march of the makers. And as a convener pointed out, there's been a 9.7% cut in CapEx. So I accept, however, having said that, Graeme, your comments, particularly about public sector consolidation and focusing key sectors and the move away from oil and gas. But one thing that this session has been very good for is looking at the wider perspective. So in terms of structural issues, you made that comment, and I don't know if we've ever talked about that enough in this committee. So my question is, how are the structural issues in the UK economy holding Scotland back? I fully accept there are structural issues in the Scottish economy, but looking at the macro picture, how are the UK structural issues holding Scotland back? So, since I'm looking at you, Graeme.
All right, so a few things I would say. So your general point you make as well about who controls the levers, I think is important, again, to reflect as well, in the sense that this framework means that Scotland takes the risk of its income tax performance diverging from the UK, but it's not the Scottish Government that purely controls what drives those income tax. There are these structural factors, but also UK policy choices that not just impact on Scotland, but will impact on Scotland relative to the rest of the UK. So it's nice to be at committees not mentioning Brexit, but Brexit is an example about where decisions taken at the UK will have an impact on Scottish income tax revenues. We don't know whether it's going to be worse or better in Scotland relative to the UK, but it's an example of a decision taken outside Scotland that would potentially have an impact there. So again, we have to be realistic about what this Parliament can control the relative performance there. I mean, I think in terms of the structural issues that you highlight, many of the structural issues that we've spoken about from a Scottish perspective exist at the UK level. Some of them are slightly more pronounced in Scotland, some of them are potentially less. So the UK has an ageing population too, it's just it's more rapidly ageing in Scotland. And I heard an earlier conversation about different parts of the UK ageing differently as well. And Scotland's been seen in that context. The productivity puzzle is a UK productivity puzzle. So Scotland's actually caught up with the UK in recent times in terms of productivity, but it's the UK overall that's lagging behind our key competitors. You think at regional inequalities as well, so the inbuilt regional inequalities that exist in the UK economy, and levelling up, whatever that means, is going to design to try and address that. And then you have the wider inequalities too, which, again, the Parliament control to an extent, but these wider inequalities were not just an issue in themselves, but we do know increasingly the evidence that then feeds through to issues of productivity and labour market participation and the like. So I think for me, they're the broad UK issues, which are very similar to Scotland. There's just nuances about whether or not they're more significant or less significant from Scottish perspective.
Mm-hmm. So in that respect, I accept that. So that a lot of the levers that you might choose to use reside at UK level, and you talk macroeconomic policy, there's a whole bunch of taxes, there's borrowing, which of course Scotland can't do, there's immigration you've talked about. So therefore, in terms of looking at the current budget, the current Scottish budget, is your assessment of that that the Scottish Government is doing the best it can with pretty limited, I don't want to put words in your mouth, I'm not trying to do that, with fairly limited fiscal levers? And you can put your own words to it. But the reason I'm asking that question is that consistently, whether it's the Economy Committee or this committee, we have all been agreed that post-2008 and post-COVID requires really quite radical policy choices. And yet this entire session has brought out the limitations that the Scottish Government has when we look at macroeconomic policy, when we look at levers. So I suppose I'm trying to get a sense of, you know, again, it links back to if it were me, what would I be doing? And every single thing I thought of
we couldn't do. Every single radical thing I thought of, we couldn't do. So you're the expert, both of you. I'm not merely a committee member, so I'd appreciate your thoughts.
I'll maybe dodge two parts of your question there. One about what would happen if Scotland controlled more of those levers, because that opens up a whole series of questions about macroeconomics and different constitutional settlements, and whether the Scottish Government are doing the best they could. That's ultimately a kind of a decision for you guys to scrutinise the government and see whether you think that they're doing the best. But I think two general questions I would say about the point, though, is that under this framework, the Scottish Parliament takes the risk of income tax divergence, but it doesn't have all the levers there. So that's just a natural reflection of devolution and the fact that the nature of this framework. So decisions taken elsewhere will spill over into the relative performance, either good or bad, of the Scottish economy. And then in terms of radical policy choices, there's nothing constraining the Scottish Government within its spending envelope to do different things. I mean, that is within their gift to do it. So on the economy, if they wanted to, they could, with the money that they spend at the moment, they could do completely different things from the UK on all aspects of skills, on education or economic development. But in general, I think it's quite interesting, if you look at devolution over 20 years, there hasn't really been that radicalism in economic development policy in comparison to other areas. So you can think of things like smoking ban, you can think of things like minimum unit pricing, and there has been quite radical decisions taken in different aspects of the policy of the Parliament control. But if you look at the economy, yeah, there's differences at the margin, but there's not really that radical difference there. And that might be a consensus on what constitutes the right policies in economic growth, supply-side policies, etc. But there hasn't certainly been a difference in radicalism. But I wouldn't say that's purely because they're constrained to do that. I think it's a deliberate choice.
Last week question, sorry.
In this budget, not a budget that we might like to see.
Yeah. Last week question then to you both is the behavioural elements. You know, you talk about the Scottish Parliament taking the risk. I mean, if I was running a business, there's no way I would run a business in this way. And so how does it affect behaviours? It's sort of slightly linked, and it's probably my last question before the convener closes me down, and rightly so, I'm sure.
Sorry, so, by behaviours, in terms are you talking about?
Yeah, I suppose what I'm trying to get at is that given that that is a risk, does that actually act to diminish appetite for change? Because if taking the risk, as you highlight, Graham, around differential tax policies, does that inhibit behaviours?
Right, I see. I thought you were going to ask about behavioural responses to tax change, but I think I've just realised that that's not what you're asking about. Political culture and behaviours, are you?
Yeah, linked to, because there'll be economic outcomes, so the two are linked.
I don't know if I have any immediate thoughts about political cultures and behaviours and how these influence policy, actually, I have to say.
No, I mean, what I would say on economic development policy, I think, coming back to my earlier point, there is a consensus that if you look at what we need to do to create a better economy, then I think most people would agree on what they are. You know, it's skills, it's investment, it's tackling inequality, it's those things that are there. So there's probably broad consensus across most policymakers and most economists about what that would be. I think the relative balances, well, how do people weight things more than the others? And it may be that the nature of this framework means that you're always comparing what we're doing to the rest of the UK, and that might constrain behaviour. So it's maybe less of an issue about risk, but more of just about, well, how much are you spending on economic development, or what's your poundage on business rates versus what's the UK's poundage in business rate? And that, the framing of that may constrain the willingness for people to be more radical if it's always going to be looked through that lens. But it's an interesting question that I think, yeah, it'd be interesting to follow up on.
Okay. Thank you, Camilla.
I sometimes think we look too much about what happens in the UK, not perhaps beyond our borders a bit more, where there'd be many more ideas that we could perhaps look at. But That brings us to the end of our time. I want to thank both our guests, both David and Graham, for once again providing some very thought-provoking and helpful evidence for our scrutiny. So thank you very much. And we'll just have a one-minute break so our witnesses can leave, and then I'll have a couple of minutes with members of the committee to update them on a couple of important matters. So thank you.